like two or three. It's not much. I don't have it here. I just say it's right online. It's the front page of the website. It's easy. And I think I'll send it to you. It's not. The articles you've already written, this is all just rehab. But you're not going to want to repeat everything you've already done. Oh, okay. Well, it's similar.
What was the turnout yesterday?
52%.
Holy cow.
For presidential and 34 for local. So one third of the voters decided not to vote while they were there on the local ballot, which is interesting.
That's not comforting.
I said to one of the selectmen, "Look, you're doing a good job. They didn't even need to vote, and they were there." No, there was nothing except town meeting. There was a lot of empty seats. Right. I don't think there was any contested town meeting. Literally, there was not even a town meeting contested. Zero. Maybe for the first time. A bunch of chairs next door. But don't stay next door.
Oh, is he starting?
No, he's got to come here. There's no meeting next door. He's just going to get a chair. Unless he thinks I'm mad at him and he just went to solve. I know. You drive RCT.
Chief, I won't lock the door.
Good call.
All right. I'd like to call the Finance Committee to order this evening.
Nice full turnout.
Oh, nine.
Awesome. Yeah, we're all here, which is great. Tonight is the first of the budget review sessions, of which we're expecting at this point three, I think. So Wednesday. Mostly listening, asking questions for these first three sessions. And then at the end, Finance Committee ends up putting together the recommended budget that goes to town meeting. Obviously based on the town manager's budget, if there are any other discussion points, amendments, or whatever, we discuss those through after we've had the three meetings. So that's kind of the plan. Tonight, first meeting focuses on the town side, town manager, kind of a presentation and overview, and then we have basically the department heads visiting this evening. Thank you guys all for coming, guys and gals. And that's kind of our schedule for tonight. We had one other item that we were going to talk about, which related to the topics we discussed at our last meeting. And I would suggest that we may want to hold that back. Let's see how we get through this first part of the agenda first and see where we are for time. Is that all right? With that, let me turn it over to you, Bob, and off we go.
Thanks, Mark. In the FinCom packet, there's a copy of this presentation. It's an abbreviated one of one you've seen. But I thought that it was helpful for the people that might be at home watching this or that may YouTube it later for us to just go through a really fast version of it as an overview. And it goes along with the first couple pages of your budget as well. Just for some background, and I'll do it at a little bit of a higher level for FinCom since this is all familiar to you. There's a list of recent accommodated costs and the resulting operating budgets. With the exception of the current year we're in, the operating budgets have been around 3.5%, and you can tell from the discussions that even 3.5% is sometimes a bit uncomfortable. More on that later. And there's the free cash used, that was in answer to your early question, to balance the budget at the annual town meeting, so not the net. And then you can see revenues on the far right-hand side without free cash at all, which is the real number you should be looking at. So we're looking at revenues between 1.5% and 3%, and then projected out a little bit below 3%. It's really helpful to know that municipal growth revenue-wise in the state is below just below 4%, which is substantially higher than it is in Reading. I mean, 1%'s a big deal, especially over a long period of time. And for the last 5 years, it's trended down to 3.8%. You can see in this period here, this 27-year period before then, it was over 5%, again, statewide. And I know we were very rarely at 5%, except in the year we had an override. So Reading's, you know, revenue is certainly at a slower pace. And a lot of that has to do with development, you know, and lack of real estate to develop. Prop 2.5 certainly constrains your revenue rate. And then state aid has lagged, and we'll get to that. Just for the general public, some of the expenses we can certainly do a good job managing, but some of them really do come out of left field. For instance, last winter in snow and ice, there's really not much you can do planning-wise except be ready. Health insurance, and then some of the mandates that get sent down to us in an unfunded state. A history of Prop 2.5 and debt exclusion and capital exclusion in the town of Reading. I won't spend a lot of time on that, but this will just be available on the website. We haven't done anything effectively since 2003 in terms of the operating budgets. We have had two debt exclusion votes for the library in 2013 and 14. But you can see that prior to 13 and 14, there was a really busy stretch in just 3 years from 2000 to 2003, consisting of both successful and failed overrides and questions. This is the summary in a nutshell of state aid. Again, the source is the Massachusetts Budget and Policy Center, and they adjust all this state spending money for inflation. And they come up with the fact that local aid allocation is down by almost a half, a little bit more than a half. And if you look, all their categories are down except this one, healthcare. As I say, that's no way to run a country. Locally, this is our new growth. That's Reading in red, and the 2 years we did better than our neighbors were the development of the landfill down in Walker's Brook. Otherwise, we have consistently lagged in new growth. And again, the primary reason for that, I think, is lack of developable land. Most of our neighbors have substantially more than we do. Wakefield, not so much anymore. But North Reading and Wilmington have significantly more, and Stoneham has had more. This is a look at our peer communities. I'm just going to go quickly through some peer community analysis. I think the map is a little more helpful. We omit the city of Woburn because of its form of government, and then some of the ones geographically that are further away are statistically similar to Reading. One could argue whether as a labor market they're really a competitor or not, but nonetheless, you know, when you use such a large number as 25, things kind of work out.
Just to clarify, is this the 25 that the consultant came up with?
22 of them were designed by the first consultant 7 or 8 years ago, and the recent consultant added 3 more, so yes. Yeah. So FinCom's policy technically is the 22. We haven't had you update it. And I know that John Doherty has heard from the FinCom and is intending to use these 25 from now on as best he can. He's generally used a very similar list, a smaller list, mm-hmm. in the past.
Yeah.
Do we look like our peers? Certainly in population, pretty close. We're a little bit larger, a little bit smaller in square miles, so we're a little denser in Reading. Everyone knows that. We have less roads, but again, per square mile, we're also more roads. And as a cut-through for two major highways, that's a significant factor. We have much more wear and tear on our roads than an average typical community would have because we're a cut-through community. Our assessed value is a little bit low, and most importantly, the equalized value per capita in Reading is quite a bit low, and I'll get into that shortly. Form of government, our peers have 72% town managers, 28% town administrators, so very similar. So here's where Reading stands versus all 25 peers in that equalized value per capita. We're on the low side. And that's how much you can tax, so that's an important figure. but this is really the important summary here, is Reading gathers 60% of its annual revenue from the property tax, and our peers collect almost 67% from the property tax. We each gather about $54 million from residential. They do a much better job collecting property tax from commercial, industrial, personal property. So we're about the same in residential. You know, they're collecting another $12 million a year in CIP. And just to cover one thing which came up at the financial forum, one of the things the selectmen do every year is have a tax classification hearing in October usually, and they decide whether to split the rate or keep it the same. And just to make it really clear for everyone, because I guess it wasn't, if the selectmen chose to split the rate and tax businesses more, that does not create more tax revenue. That just shifts the burden within the class. So it would relieve some of the tax burden on some single family homes and shift it to businesses, but it does not cause new revenue. So this $12 million shortfall is not due to the fact that the selectmen refused to split the rate. Now, it's true that if they did split the rate and they split it to the average of the communities on this list, we would be collecting another $2 million from commercial, industrial, personal property, but we would be collecting $2 million less from residential. So just to be real clear about that. Because we have more kids, our state aid is higher, and because we have to rely on some income, it has to, and then local receipts, and a big factor there is the dividend from the light department. Do we spend money differently? The answer is really no. We spend a little bit more on public safety. Culture is generally the library, a little bit less down here, but all of these are so close to the average that it's not really significant. But certainly one number that jumped out when I first saw this was education. You know, it's saying that we spend an average amount of our budget on education, maybe a tiny bit higher. And that took a little more investigation. How do we do versus our peers? Well, here's, you can see, again, all those figures look like we are pretty close to average, but when you start looking at individual categories, and Reading was typically average, we're one of the few communities that's average. Everyone does, you know, all kinds of things. One of the communities spends half their budget on education, and this is, again, higher per capita income. Two of the high per capita income communities spend a lot less, so there's no real pattern there. But you can see there's generally an upward spending slope, meaning that if you have, you know, better income communities, you tend to spend more on education. So this also says we're an average spender. And none of that ties out to the per pupil number that the schools always talk about, and they're right. And this is the reason why it doesn't tie out. Out of the 26 communities on the list, here's where Reading stands in terms of the amount of students enrolled in the public schools. So these communities have a higher percent of students enrolled out of a population, but most communities have less. In other words, we have a lot of kids. So we're spending an average amount of dollars on our schools, but we have more children to educate with those dollars. Thus, the per pupil is lower. For FinCom's benefit especially, this is a flawed report from the state where they don't count our stabilization fund for some reason. But if they do, we're just a little bit north of where this data point is. You've discussed whether 5% or 10% or some other figure in between is the right number. I don't know what the right number is, but you can see most communities do much better than 5%, and I have to say this surprised me also. I do know there's a lot of communities that have a lot of reliance on stabilization funds, especially capital stabilization funds, and we've historically not really done that. We just leave it in free cash. Now to get to the town's budget and the town manager's budget. When we sat down in the fall, all the department heads were encouraged to request what they thought the department should have and what they hear from the community. And the requests came in at about $1.6 million more than we had available from the FinCom guidance. And this year, the FinCom guidance given in October, November never really changed the operating budget. Some years it does as we find other accommodated costs to cut. But this year, it really stayed about the same. So that meant that, you know, with all these figures here, we had to somehow come up with $1.6 million to cut, and I'll get into that shortly. Level funding is a concept the schools have discussed every year. We generally have not. So we got together and talked to them and have used their methodology. And the budgets, again, submitted, or I should say the money available was $700,000 more or less short of what a level funded budget would be, and I'll also come back to that. In order to cut $1.6 million out of the requests, these are the things that I looked at. I was pretty adamant that I did not want to add any staff, even to accommodate a level service budget if I had to lay off staff. And I'm sure I said in the write-up that this is not a hard, fast rule. If we had to hire someone for public safety because, you know, it was a safety issue, we would have. So that we had the luxury of being able to go along with number one this year. An issue you've heard from both the town and the schools more in the last year, but it's been true for probably 3 or 4 years, is staff retention is a real difficult thing. It's becoming a challenge. The labor markets have changed in the last 2 or 3 years, so we've noticed a lot more, but it's been a challenge for a while. Effectively, on the town side, what we've always tried to do philosophically is pay people an average wage. We haven't been successful at that, but that's been the goal. And that seems like a reasonable thing considering Reading's financial situation, but it's not necessarily an easy thing to pay a staff at an average wage and then demand very high quality work from them. And you know this community does require high quality work from the staffs. Third one, there's no significant service cuts in the town's budget. There are some small changes. And then there are less cushions in some expenses. So for instance, I have a pretty good idea that there'll be some retirements in certain departments, and normally we would fund something for that. We didn't this year. I said, unless I absolutely know that there's going to be something that's going to happen, I'm not about to lay off someone else just because of something that might happen. So it's possible that, as opposed to the typical year, we might have to come back to the November town meeting or April town meeting because something happened and we didn't seem to be as prepared for it as we typically would be. These are the things that were cut from the level services budget, and I have no intention of reading them all. I know I've done that in the past. But it's a combination of positions actually eliminated versus positions not added. And there's a bit of an art there. It's not so much of a science. The schools do a similar thing. It's a little easier for a school to, for instance, target a class size and say that they need another teacher to hit that class size so that a level service budget would be one more teacher. It's a little harder for us to come up with a metric like that, but one fairly easy one to look at is our population has grown about 4 or 5% in the last few years with some of the housing. That's one or two police officers and one or two firefighters. That's a real simple one. So that's kind of the philosophy we used on level service. Of more interest and a list that got a little more scrutiny is that $1.6 million gap between level services. I got a couple of comments from the public that department has just requested frivolous things because that's what you all do. And I showed them the list, and they said, okay, so it wasn't as frivolous as I thought. There's not a lot of things here that people wouldn't recognize as a more or less genuine need, like a second school resource officer. We're not even pretending to call that level service because it's clearly something new. Would it be good to have? Of course it would. But again, here's the list of things that weren't done from a level or from a sort of extra request basis. And this is what the town's budgets look like put together between the accommodated cost and the operating cost. You're looking at about a 2.5% increase. And facilities is new to you this year on the town side. That I think that had the highest increase, 5.5%. Joe's a pretty tough negotiator. Looking forward, it's quite clear, and this comment has been made probably for 3 years in a row. We've put it off. We've gotten some luck. We've had a lot of free cash to use, but absent something really stupendous in the next 6 months, we will be laying off more staff. And I believe on the town side we're really to the point that we can't really lay off any more staff without eliminating a service or severely impacting the quality of the service. We have thinned out, we have job shared, we have some positions that are shared by departments, a person shared by departments. I don't really believe we can eliminate more staff without really the public noticing. So these are the options we'll have, is eliminating services and really impacting the quality of them. So again, $700,000 a year would hit our level service. And last year it was a very similar number. I think it might have been a little bit higher. And $1.6 million a year would take care of things that the community may well desire. And the thing that's hidden from this budget entirely, but the department well know, the community comes up with a lot of requests during the year that we don't even consider asking for. You know, if you ever really wanted us to come up with a list, I'm sure we get a pretty significant list that's more than $1.6 million. The volunteers in this community are great, but they ask a lot. They want to volunteer because they want to be engaged, and when they're engaged, they want to do a lot. And we just don't have the staff, for one thing, to support all those volunteers. But a handful of the boards I can think of right now want to add another employee to do X. We don't even show that because it's so far off the range of possibilities. But if you really wanted to make, you know, the community as a whole happy, it'd be impossible. You know, there's not enough money. It's just impossible. But I thought that background would be helpful just for you to be reminded of, and the community maybe to see. And now we'll just kind of go through the budget. And I'll skip the town manager's overview because I've really just done that. But I want to launch into the to the benefits section, into the, I guess I'll start with the spending scorecard. It's a little hard to see. I'll just read off a couple numbers that are important. I think most importantly, the total general fund budget is 2.6%. It's very modest. You know, the town and the school budgets are each similar. We're a little bit lower. They're a little bit higher because of accommodated costs. And once again, we've done a really good job managing our accommodated costs. But I have to say that that number there, that 2%, is influenced by the fact we just did a slug of capital at November town meeting. This number would be much higher if we weren't going off that higher base of capital spending. So if you look at the difference here, you can see there's a big drop in capital because we just did $600,000 in November town meeting. And you know, you may or may not be able to be in a position to need to do that and have the cash to do that in any given year.
Have we gotten a health care cost yet?
At 5 o'clock tonight. I'm holding it in suspense. He knows. I get to it in this section. It's not too bad. All the employees don't know you. This is great. I apologize, in your original packet on page 10, we forgot that Joe Huggins existed, so the facilities department's now over here somewhere. And the one up on the website has the facilities department there.
Guess he's not that good.
No. Mark pointed out that in the write-up, we're saying free cash use. It's really $2 million. We'll correct the write-up. This was at a point where the governor had just come out with state aid and it was low, after we found an expense to cut that didn't require an increase of $2 million. So we'll fix that. But here I want to spend some time before the department heads come up and just talk about this section just a little bit. On page 16 of your budgets, which I'll get to here. Can everyone read that, or is it too small? That's the trouble. We don't have enough. It's too small. I just want to point out a couple highlights, and I'm certainly happy to answer any questions. The retirement board has a target, if you don't recall, of 4.5% a year. So they keep increasing the pension assessment by 4.5%, and that's challenging because our revenues are, you know, 3% or not even 3%. But that's what they're targeting to fund by 2028, I hope.
29.
Close enough. This year, we've level funded OPEB because the discussion a few years ago was increase it every year until you get to $500,000 and then just leave it there. So that's what we've done. You can see that town meeting has to move the money this year in April, so none's been moved yet. This $500,000 is somewhere around, it's not quite a third of what our annual OPEB contribution should be, somewhere between a quarter and a third the last time I looked. The thinking being that when the pension fund is fully funded, we'll shift that extra money over to OPEB. And Sharon and I have looked at some numbers and with a lot of assumptions as to what happens, but leaving the 4.5%, It looks like when we do that in 2028, it'll actually cost less money in total. So there'll be a little bit of extra to fund OPEB. Will be a little easier than to fund the, and that's just to fund the annual amount. If we were trying to do some catch up and have a target, that's different. But to just fund the annual amount, there'd be less money needed.
Right, so that's assessed every year, that percentage?
Every 2 years.
Oh, okay, because when I saw that, I didn't realize that was...
We get an evaluation every 2 years and have an idea of what the annual contribution should be for both
sort of rerun
pension
numbers.
And OPEB, yeah. Yeah, and historically, when they've rerun it, it's come down for two reasons. One is because we're partly funding it, so they use a different discount rate, which is kind of artificial, but it is what it is. And the other is their wage assumption on town employees was just too high. And, you know, the wages have some bearing on this. And OPEB, the health insurance premiums, went up at a much slower rate. I did want to point out the workers' comp, which is on page 16, if I can find that. Oh, I skipped the health insurance, didn't I?
Mm-hmm.
That's because I'm going to have to get to workers' comp first. If you look back here, you know, we were spending $270,000 a year on workers' comp, and that was almost all premium, $266,000. We worked really hard to put in some safety programs, both primarily in DPW and facilities, and look at the success of that. We don't usually talk about successes, we just do them. I thought it was just worth pointing out that we're now getting back to what that level was 5 years ago. So effectively, you know, there's been no increase over 5 years. And that's one of the few accommodated costs that we actually can have some influence over. It's a lot more obvious in this example, in health insurance, a lot less obvious. We've done a lot of work in health insurance too, but it just goes up so much that we can't bear it. And I know you're just dying to know the number over there. 7.6%.
Was that based on claims?
There is a 2-year, I think, tail on claims, so yeah.
And then they also evaluate what programs you already have in place?
They have a scoring system, so I don't know, there's 100 points you can get depending on how proactive you are, and we generally score very high, but we jumped up a little bit a few years ago to a higher level. And that doesn't mention the rebates we get. So we do get rebates, but we decided that wasn't proper to show it in the budget. That just goes to free cash, so I don't know, what do we get, 60 or 80 grand?
Yeah, sometimes 70, 90.
Okay.
That's great.
For property casualty.
What about the programs? You said the safety and training programs that we're doing to get those. How much are we spending roughly on those?
Time. Employees.
Yeah,
time.
Right. But nothing incremental.
Yeah. Maya runs some stuff for free. You know, Jeff and his group and Jane primarily run sort of the Maya Rewards program, if you will. So it's been successful, but it takes, you know, some time away from work.
Sure, right.
Clearly for some of the employees. We did get health insurance today, 7.6%. As a reminder, the Maya pool was 8.9 was the average. So you see, you're really happy about a 7.6.
Right.
Who would have thought that?
Managing expectations.
So Bob, just a quick question. So 270,000 premiums cost on workers' comp, roughly on how much payroll, total payroll?
Oh boy, 20 million?
20 million.
Something like that. Oh, that's only the town side. It's much more. I don't know.
And the claims, what did you say about the claims? Do we have high claims, low claims? Picture.
Well, first of all, public safety is excluded. So,
right.
Those are sometimes the more serious ones. No, we don't really have high claims. Sometimes we have a really, RMLD had a really serious incident a couple years ago with a really high claim. But broadly speaking, no.
I'm only asking, it seems high to me from a premium perspective, just comparing to the corporate side, what we pay.
Well, we pay about, I don't know, $75 million in wages total, RMLD, schools, and town, I'm guessing. So.
And we bid up, do we do normally annually?
No, we actually haven't in a while. We go through Maya.
Okay.
Their renewal rates have been good.
Okay.
And they, as I said, they provide a lot of extra for free. There's some value for both health insurance and property casualty having Maya versus otherwise we'd have to hire someone in order to do some of the things they do for us.
You mean as a broker?
From an HR standpoint.
Okay.
They offer a lot of training. They do a lot of the work between, for instance, Blue Cross and the town for health insurance that we would have to hire at least one person to do. So
it comes with.
It's okay, yeah. The health insurance increase means that this budget is fine. Quite honestly, we might be able to reduce that budget next November town meeting. We'll have to see how things go. We never know about enrollment, but by then we probably will. So there might be a little bit of a surplus. Again, it's really kind of disturbing to think that 7.6 is good news because our revenues are growing at less than 3. In looking at a long-term financial picture of the town, I happen to use 7.5%, and it's a killer. You know, when your revenues are coming in at 3 and or 2.5, it's just very difficult. I don't know, you know, what the long-term solution of this. I guess we'll have to see. This is another thing here, opt-out, that I wrote up a little bit about. I'm really very philosophically opposed to it. It's like paying farmers not to farm. We're paying employees to take their spouse's health care plan at another employer. And obviously, if all employers were doing that, we'd all be just throwing money out the window. We resisted it for many years, but our savings are tangible. We've saved $300,000 or $400,000 by net by doing this. So there we go. Let's see. I think that really covers the benefits section pretty well, and I'm not going to go over capital in much detail. It's a pretty extensive capital plan, but I want to point out just a couple things. Make it a little bigger. You can see the FinCom target number would have been even higher, but this was your second year of deferring some and not funding capital at 5%. It's 4.75%, so that cuts 200,000 out. But we didn't fund almost 100,000 below where you would have even suggested, for the simple reason that none of the next capital items were that small. They were all larger, so we just happened to round it basically down, if you will. And you can see the plan going forward is pretty close to your target, as close as can be. And this capital plan, for what it's worth, is pretty much balanced for the next 4 years. We know things will change, and it won't be, but for now it is. And I really want to draw your attention to this number right here at the end. We have an $8 million projected surplus in the capital plan, so that if we stuck at 5%, what we're saying is we don't need it. However, there are things that aren't here that are clearly very important. There's nothing in here assumed for the Killam School, and you've had that discussion in the past. There's nothing for a cemetery garage or for the DPW garage. So there's three capital projects, you know, that need to be addressed. And also, as you can see from the top here, there's some sections where the budgeting needs to take a harder look in the out years. Departments typically do a really good job of 5 years, and then they just need to sometimes look further out. When it's a recurring item, it's pretty easy to put in there, but it's somewhat difficult to forecast out years in capital, unless it's a vehicle. But the bottom line is, if this was our operating budget, we'd feel really happy. So the capital plan has really been a major success. It's worked out really well.
If I can just add to that for a sec, the flip side, however, is with that $8 million you just mentioned, we're kind of, by not spending it, it's going into the operating budget, right?
Well, when we get out there, presumably that's where it would go, or you wouldn't use free cash and it would bill or something like that, yeah.
Right.
So if that number were real and we really didn't need it, I'm sure we'd just come to an agreement that we just spend less on capital.
Right.
But I suspect that's not a perfectly clear number. Again, if we put in $3 million for Killam, that takes almost half, or whatever Killam would cost.
And do you know what that number is if we assumed 4.75%?
It's about $200,000 a year difference. So not a huge amount.
Cumulative, just that many years.
Well, I don't know, what's that?
Yeah.
$1.5 million, something like that.
Oh, and the only thing I'd say, I think we did learn the one lesson last year with some of these capital projects, is get a jump on them sooner, so that if we need to adjust, we can do that in time to get them done.
Yeah, we've certainly run into difficulty with a couple issues. The field behind Killam wasn't done last year and delayed because the prices just came in high. We had a couple issues in the enterprise funds for the same reason. And from my perspective, the most troubling isn't so much the bids that come in, but the amount of bids. there's just not a lot of bidders out there for the work we want to do, and that's very troubling, because that tells you you're going to be paying. You know, for the library project, we didn't have a lot of bids, believe it or not. You know, we only had a handful of bidders for general contractor. You might have expected 8 to 10. I can't remember. We got 4 or 5. You know, it worked out fine. But what we're finding more and more in the municipal space is it's not so much of a free market anymore. You know, there's very limited amount of appetite to do the work, because it's very difficult to do work in the public sector. And, you know, it's almost as if they just kind of wink and take turns bidding. And there's a lot of demand. Think of the infrastructure of the state of the country. There's not the capacity to do all the infrastructure work that's needed, even if there was the money. So it is a troubling thing, and it definitely bears watching as to how real are these numbers. When it's a vehicle, it's not bad. You can pretty much pick up on the internet what it's going to cost. But for some of the the projects that are a little bit different, it's really hard to know, especially when you get into water and sewer.
I think the other lesson there has been bid assume in the budget a realistic number, meaning sometimes higher than we have estimated in the past.
Yeah, I would certainly prefer that. And that's easy to do in water and sewer. It's a little harder to do in the general fund because you're taken away from something. But in water or sewer, you're just raising the rates. And if you don't spend it, you don't spend it. But I agree with you. So that's all I have in the overview. If anyone has any questions, I'd be certainly happy to answer them. Mark asked one question earlier that I guess I'll just go to the debt service schedule to answer, just to point out. This is going so slow. Could be the operator.
Density issue?
It could be. It's an age thing. The excluded debt, if I can find it. Oh, stop. Now it doesn't even like me.
6.
Here we go. Let me actually go to the detail. Here's our debt exclusion right here. So this is FY17 right here. This $299,000 is an estimate. The rest of these are known. So we have about $3 million in debt exclusion. And you can see that creeps down over time. So when you think of a taxpayer and a tax bill, this is actually a slight downward bias on the tax bill. And then you can see as you get out to here, where the high school first is repaid and then the library next, we don't refinance, this will go away. So this will be, you know, tax relief absent any other changes. So I just, you know, Mark asked a question, I thought I'd just point that out. I guess we do have some small number in there for the cemetery garage, $1.5 million still, but I think we know that that's probably not sufficient.
Yeah. I think one of the things that'll be very helpful as we're talking about exhibits, which we can do later, is to be able to break down that typical tax bill in terms of permanent and exclusion stuff and by activity what the exclusion was. And I know it's like 2026 before it really dives, but it's not going up. There's a little downward slope to it.
And our taxes collected are about $60 million, so $3 million of that is, you know, roughly 5%. That just gives you a quick answer. So at this point, I'd like to introduce Matt Cornelis, our Administrative Services Director. And interestingly enough, he'll talk about Administrative Services.
I bet you can't wait. Thank you. Bob's a hard act to follow, so you're not expecting all of that. But it's good to meet everybody. I've been here about 10 months now, so this is my first go-around with the budget. And I know I've seen all of you out there, but I don't know that I've met everybody personally, so it's good to be here tonight and finally meet you in person. Thank you. So I guess what I'll do is just go through my budget and go through some of the highlights. I'm sure you're interested in what went up, and then open it up to questions after that, if that's the way it usually works. So I'm the Administrative Services Director. Our department consists of 5 divisions, and we have Operations, Town Manager's Office, Human Resources, Technology, and the Town Clerk's Office. The budget, my budget is pretty much level funded. Actually, if you take out the pay in class money, it's actually gone down about 3%. So there aren't really many major changes from last year, but I'll go over what we have, and if you have the actual line items before you, I can go over those as well. So the first part of the budget is operations, and this is the part of the budget where we have a lot of shared staff, we have postage, we have communications, constituent services, all under that part. The major increase there, the major part of this budget would be the pay in class funding, and that's funded at $105,000 this year. So following this, we'll decide, you know, how that's going to be divvied out, and we'll look at the pay in class structure. But it's housed right here in this part of the budget.
Excuse me one second, Matt. On the executive assistant line in fiscal 16,
mm-hmm.
we had a big pop. So I assume this is more more shared services into that.
Where are you seeing a pop?
So if you go to the exec assistant, yep. you go to the 60, there's 40.
This is year to date spending, this column.
Got it. Okay, so yep. 63, 67, 70.
Right.
Thank
right.
you.
The other small increase in this budget is actually a lease copier. We're trying to combine, now that facilities is part of the town, we have a lot of combined budget items in my budget, and operations budget. So you'll see an increase there in terms of the copier lease, which is under expenses. Other than that, that budget is pretty flat. We just hired this week a business administrator. She's actually here tonight, so I'll point her out, not to put her on the spot. Jane Miller. She's going to be handling a lot of budget issues and also communications, and she's here tonight just to learn about the process as well. So I'd like to welcome Jane. Some of the department heads haven't even met her yet. She just started this month.
Cool.
As we move to the town manager's budget, that consists of several divisions as well. Obviously, selectmen, finance committee, legal services, property insurance. And I guess the finance committee has a $150,000 reserve fund that's not included in this budget but's voted on separately, and I'm sure you know that. One of the increases would be to the town manager wages, and we've moved Bob to a 40-hour week employee. We all know he works, you know, probably 340 hours a week, but so that's the increase there, and it's not that big of an increase, but I wanted to point that out. Besides from that, the town manager's budget is fairly flat. If you look now to the legal budget, there are some issues there. We can't predict if we're going to have any TLT litigation funding needed this year, so it's not planned in there. And I can't, because of the nature of the litigation, I can't really go into it, but that's one change from last year. I've also bumped up the Labor Council because we have been working on a couple of special projects, and also we're going to start looking into the collective bargaining agreements, which expire next year, so we're getting a head start on that as well. Human Resources Division, that division, a lot of people don't know, but it supports the town. It also supports a major part of the school department, also municipal light department, and retirees. So it's an extremely busy department. One thing we just did last month is we hired an HR generalist position to help out with our department. That position is actually shared with the schools. So he's here, his name is Sean Donahue. He's here 3 days a week and then 2 days at the school. And it's a good example of shared services. It's a busy department. Since I started in May, I think we've filled over 30 positions just on the town side due to people leaving, retirements, other funded positions. And it is a challenge sometimes to find the right people for these positions. But through pay and class funding and a few other things, we've been able to do it and have a really good staff here. As we move to the technology portion of the budget.
I was just thinking about the expense piece. Is there any way to flatline that more? Because it does look like, and I don't know how realistic it is not to have anything in next year's budget, considering what we've been going through.
Mm.
We're comfortable going with zero into next fiscal year?
Well, that's one of the things I mentioned. I don't know. I just signed an invoice today. We should have been done by now, so I can't say when
we're right, because we keep pouring more in,
right.
And all of a sudden we're...
Not, we haven't spent a lot since October, November. You can see year-to-date, where is it, 90,000?
Mm-hmm.
we budgeted a little more, so, you know, there's room there. I can't predict, and I will say that if it continues to go on at this sort of unusual pace of $5,000-some months, $200 some months, we have no budget, but obviously our labor council and our legal will carry us for a while because we're not going to spend all that. If it's urgent and all of a sudden we need money, as we did last year, if we don't have a special town meeting, we'll ask you.
Right.
But I don't know how
not
we can predict.
No.
We'll put the hat in pants. It's one of those things, and that's really, you know, health insurance is hard to predict, but this is impossible.
Right, so you almost hate to see it coming out of the department budget.
You know, if you wanted to take some more money out of free cash and put a number there, you could, but we might not need it. I just don't know.
Right.
And, you know, given your guidance of $2 million, I certainly wasn't going to crowd out some other expense and put it in there.
But the other interesting thing is that we had been spending a lot in the last 2 years, right?
Yeah, you can see 170 grand this year, then we're way down this year.
Yeah.
So hopefully the end is near, but be careful what you hope for.
And it's one of the asterisks that we have to put next to the free cash balance also, is just that.
Yeah.
Don't know. It could help, it could hurt, but we don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point.
Thanks. So technology budget, I'm moving to that next, and technology is the central place where we have computer services, telecommunication services, internet, audio, visual, the usual suspects there. We're centralizing some of the expenses from facilities again into this budget. So wireless communications is now centralized, and there's a facilities work order system that's $7,500 that's now centralized in this budget. So some of these items are new, or at least new to me. We're also going to request an elder services software system at the April town meeting. This will be able to track both volunteers and residents, and the annual cost of that is $2,000. So we have that budgeted in as well under technology. Some of the larger increases in technology as we move to the page, regarding, I think it's page 40, public safety software, there's an increase there, and that reflects the fact that we've added the fire department to that software. Before it was just the police department, and that's ongoing. And then GIS software, we used to share that expense with RMLD, and RMLD no longer shares that expense with us, so now we're paying essentially the full freight. So that's why that line item has gone up to $29,000.
So does that mean they have their own GIS resource?
We used to share hardware and software, and they decided they wanted to just be by themselves.
Right. So we're by ourselves as well. The town clerk's office, I think everybody knows after yesterday what they do, elections, and they worked very hard. They worked very hard yesterday and went very smoothly, and I was very happy with that. It also includes voter registration, census, town meeting, licenses, historic documents. The major increase there, obviously, is we're in a presidential election year, so there's an increase in the election workers' salaries, so that's gone up quite a bit. Other than that, it's fairly flat in terms of the town clerk's budget. So that's just an overview of the expenses that we have that have gone up that I thought you'd be interested in. I'm happy to answer any questions. Bob had a slide earlier about things that weren't funded. Obviously, there are things that I asked for that weren't funded, but we know the constraints of the budget, so we make do what we have.
Any questions, folks?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Town accountant Sharon Angstrom, unless I find a finance budget, will be all set.
It starts on 57 slide. You got it. Step 17.
Yep.
They can read that? Okay.
Yeah, I'll go to the line items.
Okay. So starting on page 57, as Bob is showing, is the finance budget and the narrative that goes with. You'll notice that it shows the budget down 7.6%, but that's kind of an illusion, given that we have $88,000 coming out of the budget for the revaluation for the assessing department. We do a revaluation every 3 years, and it actually is coming up in fiscal 17. However, the expense related to it hits at the end of fiscal 16, and so the money's in fiscal 16, and nothing's needed in fiscal 17. So you go from 88 to nothing, and so that makes the budget a little bit just going down. Without that, our budget's really going up about 3.1%. And I added a couple of charts, and I figured I'd touch base on them, just to show you just some of the data that we have that we haven't shown in the past. Property tax exemptions over the last 6 years, you see a drastic decline. And in the area of veterans is a big area that there's, you know, we're not quite sure if there are people that qualify for this exemption and just don't apply. But there's definitely a significant decline, which helps our revenues, because if we give up the exemption, we get less revenue. So it's going the right direction for us in terms of revenue. But then you wonder, with such a decline, are people leaving Reading because they just can't afford to live here, and then they're not able to take advantage of the exemption? I'm not quite sure what it means in terms of, are we not doing a good enough job reaching out to people who may be in need of this exemption? But definitely in the area of veterans, we've seen a sharp decline. So. Just a informational something, you know, because in the area of finance, we are assessing the taxes, collecting the taxes, abating taxes, paying bills, paying payroll, issuing debt, all that sort of thing. So to give just some information that maybe we haven't shown before, just for information purposes.
So Sharon, could, if we think about the elder exemption, that would be built into that number also?
But from talking to the assessor, I think it's very, the guidelines of how you would qualify for the exemption are very stringent, and so they have an annuity sitting somewhere over $50,000 and they're immediately excluded regardless of what their income is. And so I feel like people just struggle to qualify for it, and then I also wonder how many people really know about it too. You know, I know that it's always out there, but if they're not looking for it, they don't know. Sometimes we'll have people come in and speak to the treasurer about problems with paying their real estate tax, and they might identify that a person might qualify and have them talk to the assessor. But you just wonder to see that kind of a decline. What's the, you know, are these people just leaving the community because they just can't afford to live here anymore? And that could be very well the case. So just figured it was some information I was able to pull, and haven't shown any data like that in the past, thought it might be useful to know. The next page, we have a couple more charts showing that our tax abatements have gone down over the years. And we do have a regional assessor who has taken a standardized approach to how he looks at these abatements, and we have, you know, reaped the benefit because we have fewer abatements. And that's, you know, obviously lost revenue when we do abate a tax. So that's actually helpful. And we are seeing an increase in motor vehicle excise bills. Significantly, but probably in line with the fact that we have so many developments, you know, condo developments, we have probably more, a higher population than we had 6 years ago, and that's probably attributable to that. In the area of staffing, you'll notice that we're up 3.1%. We did a 2% step and a 2% COLA, and it doesn't come up quite to 4% because in comparison to the prior year, we have one. In fiscal 16, there's one more day because of the leap year, so it kind of doesn't work out to exactly the 4%. And in the area of expenses, you'll see the changes in expenses are very, very meager, very small in dollars. The largest, it's in total, it's 3.2%, but the largest is in my area in accounting at 21%. If you look, it's only $750 in total. We try not to ask for more than we need. We're very frugal. But the area that the biggest changes is, as we look at the detail, you're going to see it's more professional development, and that's largely for me. As a CPA and a CGA, I have a lot of professional development that I have to do. And so I'm trying to increase it each year because it gets very expensive. But we did identify some Fred Pryor training that we can do, and it's $199 a year per person, and you can go unlimited training. So I utilize that quite a bit. But as far as being a town accountant and you have a CGA, you need to go to the MMAAA conferences, which are never local. They're three-day conferences, so you have to stay in a hotel, so they add up. So I only go to one out of the two that are offered
because they never, you know, they never close by, and they're in the same locations every year. It's just, and the timing of the second one is in June, and I'm pretty busy, but it behooves us to go to the trainings that are related to our field specifically, and so, and I also have to go because of my designation in that area. So that's where the largest increase is. It's really in the professional development, which is just about $500, and then a small, modest increase in the office supplies from $500 to $250, to $750, so a $250 increase, nothing major there. The assessors, as we mentioned, had the decrease of the revaluation. You'll see that there. It's like three lines down, the $88,000 to zero. Most things are pretty flat. Property inspections, that helps us with assessing personal property taxes, and we do some consulting there to try and identify areas where we can get more personal property tax, so that's probably money well spent. And then other areas that we have increases are the administrative services for the assessor. That is actually the assessor, the regional assessor. And so whatever percentage his pay goes up, that's what we have to take because we do the regional. But most everything else stays flat or goes down. If we found that on average we weren't spending the amount that we had budgeted, we either left it flat or reduced it. Things are lean, so we want to not add to the problem. And so some of our numbers were sufficient for us to operate, and so we felt no need to really ask for more. In the area of finance, I don't think there was much to talk about there. On the right page. The area that we almost always have to increase is for finance printing forms. That's largely printing the real estate tax bills and such. And we always are very close to our budget every year, so we try and increase it a little bit more each year just to make sure that we don't go over. Everything else remained pretty flat, $500 increase in total, so really not a lot to talk about there. So does anyone have any questions?
Questions? Can I actually take you back to the projections on pages 11 and 12? Just some of the assumptions that we're making for
projections on 11 and 12.
So let's see, 11 is town accountant's recommended revenues.
Oh, revenues.
Yeah, sorry, I'm so busy thinking about costs.
Oh, you're talking about revenues. I'm like,
sorry.
I'm on page 57.
No, can we look at
okay.
The revenues for a second? So a couple of questions, just thinking about how we're budgeting for both new growth and local revenues.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been very conservative.
I guess you can call it conservative, but by DOR guidance, we really should be somewhat conservative in the way we budget our revenues because we do a balanced budget. So
right.
Whatever we budget for revenues, we're going to spend. So you don't want to have a revenue deficit and then have to cut budgets mid-year or anything of that nature. So, but I still feel like we do a lot to figure out what those numbers should be in terms of where are we according to projection in the current year. Are we collecting on track to make what we're supposed to be budgeted for the current year? Are we ahead? What is the five-year average of what we've collected in that particular area, whether it be motor vehicle or excise tax? We do look at a lot of factors. We don't just arbitrarily put a number, but we do still tend to be conservative because you don't want to put a number out there that we want to achieve and then have shortfalls.
Agreed. I think it's a question of how conservative. So look at new growth, you know, 500 is our assumption.
Almost always change that at a later meeting once we know what
okay.
It is. Like when we're doing the tax
yeah.
rate setting,
okay.
As we approach that, the assessor will be able to get us a more solid number, and then we do adjust it and we utilize that for whatever extra we need to do at that November town meeting. So
yeah.
It usually helps out.
Yeah, I mean, it all ends up coming back. It's not an issue of, you know, found money. I think it's an issue of how are we estimating operating budgets?
So are you saying that
growth?
You think that we should be going with a higher new growth projection for 17?
I'm just wondering if there's more information that would help us say that 500 is the right number or the wrong number. Because right now, if I looked at trends, I'd say 500 seems really conservative.
I guess the way I'd answer that is if you look at the last 3 years, there's been high figures, but prior to that, there was not. The last 3 years, work is almost done. There are developments that are almost fully built.
Because we have condo developments
so you have Johnson Woods, Pulte Homes, and down on Haven Street.
and they're just about done. Johnson Woods is still...
Without knowing what's on the horizon for more development, it'd be very difficult, knowing that those projects are wrapping up.
Does improvement, home improvement, come into that number as well?
Yeah.
So can we look at permits? Is there anything we can look at that would give us more guidance?
Dean will be able to talk to you about that next week because, you know, the permits are up a lot, but I guess our assessor could break down the new growth into commercial versus residential.
It's, I know. What would you think?
Dominant,
like,
commercial.
20 or, oh, you mean in terms of, like, the breakup?
Well, we're 90-10 residential, but it's definitely not 90-10 new growth. It's definitely much more proportionally commercial. I really can't guess, though.
Yeah, I didn't know if Victor Crumb, he probably thinks about that right off the top of his head.
But it sounds like your comfort level is kind of holding at 500 as opposed to taking that number up.
Unless we got another big project that we know is going to start.
If we know that something's coming,
so.
That's a different story, but we don't. So
yep.
You got to be conservative because you don't want the number to be too high. And then as soon as we know or closer to knowing, that's when the number gets adjusted, and it's usually around November.
Just the problem is, I mean, the operating budget's well done.
You rarely have the information in advance of that.
Okay.
And also, too, as things are you don't know how far along the construction is going to be and how billable it will be. So.
Got it. The other question, very much related, is on page 12, which is the local revenue one. It's the same question, just looking at the local revenue numbers. I think we've got 3.4% in as the increase right now. Forecast of 3.4% for fiscal 17, a bit conservative to allow for this uncertainty. Is the food tax in there as well?
That's actually slowed down.
Yeah, it really has. We're kind of not seeing much of an increase at all. I mean, we've been kind of slowing our increases in that area because we barely made what we projected last year, or maybe just kind of slowed. Yeah, definitely slowing in the excise related to meals tax, or they call it an excise, it's meals tax. Motor vehicle has been trending upward. You have to wonder when that's the definite hardest one out of the local receipts, because you just don't know when that number is going to peak and start to decline. Because that's fueled a lot by new car sales, and it's a declining tax. So the longer you've owned your car, the more it goes down. And we've seen it go up for so many years. It's just so hard to know, if you're being conservative by going up, how much to go up. We tend to be as conservative as we can be, but we are taking into account what has it been in the prior year, what was it the last 3 years, and trying to stay in that arena. So we're not tremendously low, but we've been surprised over the last 3 years. And it always helps a free cash when we are surprised in that way. But we have been, in recent years, below what we projected by significant dollars. So that's a difficult one for sure, because it really is so reliant on when people decide to buy new cars and how long they decide to keep their cars.
Some of that is also reflective of the population that's increased over the last 3 years.
Yeah, because we had the new developments, there's more people. There's more people. So there's a lot to that. But we have increased it steadily over the last few years, but it's come up higher each year. So
then probably the discussion should be that if we decide that these are reasonable at this point, the likelihood of it being an extra drain on free cash is low.
Yeah.
And the possibility is that it may be a net benefit to free cash as the year goes on.
Mm-hmm. And it has been the last few years. So.
Right.
I think the general discussion with FinCom, and I'll use the number I'm comfortable with, I think you guys might be higher, is that 750 is a good regeneration number. Mm-hmm. A lot of that's revenue, if not most.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Right. And we took our regen estimate up this year, did we?
I can't remember if it was 750 or a million.
I think it said a million.
Yeah, I think we did take
that. Because I think over the last several years, we have increased free cash by $1 million, and that would mean that we actually regenerated at the rates of 2 to 3 million, because we had spent, to have it increased $1 million, you actually covered everything additional that we spent and got 1 million increase. So we've had particularly high regeneration over the last few years. but historically it's never been that high, so I wonder how long it could continue.
Hopefully.
And every year that we talk about it, the source is very different. It's not like a consistent, oh, it's always this, and, you know. I mean, the first year I was here, it was snow and ice, and snow and ice is very rarely a spot where you get free cash. It's usually where we're throwing money, at, you know, to make sure that we're covered.
I'm not going to say a word about
that. I heard that.
So, you know, it's always a surprise, some of the things that come to us. And so, then there's other things that we don't project for in terms of, because we don't know they're coming. You know, FEMA money, when we have a storm, they don't tell us when we're going to get that money. And then, so it's not usually time for us to budget and say, we're going to get FEMA money we can use. So that stuff is completely unbudgeted and just goes right into free cash. Dividends from Maya, we never know how much we're going to get. It's really largely based on how many trainings we do, and if they decide to give a dividend, which they always seem to, but they could discontinue that at any time, and you don't want to count on something that you don't know is for certain. And when we're holding money for capital projects such as the library project, we're earning interest on the money. We don't project that interest because that's, you know, we're not going to have a long term. So there's certain things that are in there that we'll probably definitely have gains on that we just, based on the way we've done things conservatively, we don't budget for, because if you don't know what's going to happen, you just don't put it in there.
Everybody good with kind of these assumptions that have built in? Everybody understand what they are at this point? Yeah.
So it might be a silly question, but why do we start paying a higher tax rate? Is it July 1 or is it the first of the year?
July 1.
Okay. There are too many people when they got their tax bills the first of the year, like, wait, did we already start paying it? Okay.
Yeah, it would be July 1.
Yeah, okay.
But I think that you get an estimated bill.
Libraries now.
I think they get an estimated bill before we actually do the valuation of when the tax should be. So I think that you actually get an adjusted bill in January. So I think that might be where people see a change.
Right.
Oh.
It's technically for the fiscal year as of July 1, but we don't know what that tax rate's going to be until we've actually done our tax recap with DOR and it's been certified. So I think they probably calculated on the old rate. So your bill looks a little, and then when you get the next bill, when it's actually
that's
been certified, that's when the rate shows.
I see.
Yeah. And so you get
that question.
Yeah.
Yes.
What's that?
Yeah.
I am the tax collector. The preliminary tax bills.
Has everyone here been paid?
Include the 2.5% Prop 2.5 increase over the prior year's bills, and then they get trued up in December when the actual bills come out, based on the tax rate versus the valuation differences.
So the difference is really valuation.
I think this year the library was also back.
Well, it was definitely in there this year. That you brought
as of November it was, but as of estimates, it was not.
Right.
Yes, it wouldn't have been in there.
So that's
we do please put in the 2.5% in the preliminary bills. The first bill is due in August.
Oh, but so you're saying
yes,
based on the valuation that was existing prior.
You take the last year's actual tax bill, add 2.5%, and divide it by
so
4,
they are
and that's how much is due on August 1st.
But they're not using
the library
tax
was
because they don't know what
doubled up
exactly.
Then?
Okay.
So well, it's a full year's worth of the library debt.
As a catch-up. That's
as
right.
A catch-up.
Yep.
So next year, in theory, it would go down by half of that.
Slightly, yeah.
Yeah. But then you got the 2.5% increase
right.
Anyway, so.
That may be worth spending some time on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So people understand it.
Right, because people have been asking me that one.
So
I guess I have to
finish.
Why did their tax bill go up?
Yeah, the
November
bills were up a bit.
Because they didn't
yeah.
Have
the August nominally would go down, right?
Yeah, because I think it would have been a catch-up on the actual bill, yeah.
August will go up.
It's going
to be based on the full year tax bill for this year, plus 2.5%.
Oh,
and it won't be until we true it up for the annual bill that they'll actually go down a little bit more.
Right. When does that true up at?
It happens in December for the bill that's due in February. So the actual tax bill is
the same one again?
Yeah, because it's built into this year. It's built into the actual tax bill this year.
Oh, because of the 2.5%.
Yes, so it's going
so
to.
So you don't look at the full year rate, you
look
at the ending rate?
We put this on a future agenda.
So then it only goes 2.5% over the full year.
Especially relevant for an override, and we've already talked about that.
But isn't it because the actual bill was high because the exclusion wasn't there, wouldn't there be a chance the bill might go down just even with the 2.5% because there's a true up that's happening in this bill? I guess that's what I was thinking.
Yeah. And Paula's idea is exactly right. Let's put that on a future agenda. Understand.
A little more complex.
Okay, so there's sort of two. Last question, total available cash, page 12 again.
You mean the free cash?
Yeah, free plus stabilization. So this chart is free, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's another chart here that looked at kind of the percent.
We were going to call it something different number.
Yeah. No, but I'm trying to figure out what's the total available cash.
Before we started this budget, we had $8.5 million of free cash, about $1.5 million in stabilization share, up around $10 million.
Okay.
And then we had used, I think it was a couple hundred thousand at the last town meeting, so probably just under $10 million. And then we're kind of, with the $2 million, you kind of have to take that out because you're kind of promising to use $2 million.
Yep,
so you're really in that $8 million arena. And then when we're doing these charts, we're kind of considering a certain amount of regeneration and use, you know, at least using $2 million a year. So that's why you see it kind of going down and project out fiscal 16 and 17. Because beyond what we actually put into the budget, we used money after we voted fiscal 16's budget at the November town meeting and such.
I think it probably would be helpful to have kind of a total reserve chart as well as the free cash one by itself, just so that we kind of have the full picture. Understand.
Kind of like what we put on the slides where we break it down.
Yeah. In fact, like a stack bar kind of thing. Is that what you're thinking, Jim?
Yeah.
I think it's also time that FinCom have a discussion about the use of the stabilization fund. Why do we have it? Should we use it? And, you know, with respect to a possible override, I've got some ideas, but that aside, why did we just park $1.5 million in there many years ago and it sits there?
Well, I think I can think of one good reason we would want a stabilization is if we had struggles getting our free cash certified and we need to use it at November town meeting, you could use a stabilization because you're not waiting to be certified where you couldn't. If we didn't get it certified prior to November town meeting,
we almost got it last year.
So it's possible. Yeah, it really could happen. Especially when we were, you know, our DOR rep had actually retired and there was no guarantee they were going to get to us quickly. Actually, I got to them really quickly and they got me done quickly, but you just don't know because you don't even know who's going to deal with you when your rep is gone. You know, like you're in the back room or just back room or so.
But should the stabilization fund be used strategically?
Yeah, the stabilization fund is just need to be certified every year. So if at November town meeting we're still waiting for free cash to be certified, stabilization is still available. We could use it as a funding source if we had something to do at November town meeting. So I think that's a reason to have it.
I'm actually in the stabilization.
But we never seem to use it because it's a 2/3 vote to get it out of there. But, you know, if that was our only option, we're at November town meeting.
I know we talked about this before, so sorry to bring it up again, but I mean, when I look at that chart again, the fact that we project that we're going to use $2 million of the reserves, if you extend that chart, it's not going to look pretty.
No.
So, I mean, is that the right way of thinking about this? I mean,
well, it wouldn't look pretty if you assume that we're using the $2 million and you're assuming a small regeneration, but I feel like in the last few years we've had very large regeneration, so we've been increasing even despite our very high use.
Right.
So it may not be as bleak as it might be as you would think, but you don't know what those regeneration numbers are until...
And that's what I've been told, is that, hey, this is what we're projecting, but hey, when you look at the actuals, that's why I think it's helpful to at some point see the actuals. What did we project? What was the actuals? And so forth. But, you know, just looking at that in silos...
Because we're assuming very small regeneration, if any.
You did have some good slides where it showed the actual regeneration.
Mm-hmm. You can certainly show more slides like that if that's not good.
I mean,
at least for me, it would be helpful being a new member.
Every generation.
Yeah. Well, I think we need to see it anyway. In the discussion we had just a few minutes ago about the assumptions that we're making in, because we're being very conservative, again, the risk of us over having to pull more out of free cash is low.
Yeah.
The chance of it coming back is higher, or some of it comes back. That's the approach that we're taking right now. But we need to see what the real impact is. That said, Bob's first slide, it's not great to be using free cash to fund the operating budget. You know, on net, we're not, as of the last at least a couple of 3-4 years, 5 years even.
Because in the end, we still end up with more free cash than we started.
We do when we start.
When we balance the budget, it looks like it's pulling down really hard. And then the other thing for me that's the wake-up call is that, you know, we're sitting here thinking, boy, we're sitting on this big pile of available funds, and then we compare ourselves with other peer communities, and we're not sitting on some massive excess at all.
True.
Yeah.
So established.
One or two nasty things happen to us, and things just don't look very good at all.
Mm-hmm.
That was the most surprising peer community piece of data I found, is the towns that are worse off than us financially by any measure, except this one. They have more cash reserves, which really surprised me.
We can't have any big problems.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the same. Any other comments, questions? Sorry I didn't give these to you sooner, Sharon.
Oh, good question.
Yeah, I kind of did a cursory.
I could have got the chart together for you. Thank you.
This is public safety. Two chiefs. Better than one. I'll just give a real quick summary, as you can see on this sort of common page. This year we've broken out our CASA just so you can see it visually separate, because it is grant funded, but it's not grant funded forever. So if you will, we've put in these sections of the budget: police, dispatch, fire, EMS, traditional, and then our CASA added as a new one. You can see the total of this line item is up 3.6% of this department, I should say. Expenses are up a little bit more than wages, but that's just a nice snapshot because, again, town meeting votes, fire, police, dispatch, and our CASA all together, one wage number and one expense number. So that's what this page is meant to show. And then I'll turn it over to the chiefs.
Which one?
I don't care.
As far as now.
Thanks for having us tonight. The fire department's budget, I just want to start with what we do. We have four major functions: fire suppression, fire prevention, emergency medical system, and also emergency management. When we look at our emergency response last calendar year, we see our responses are up a little bit, both on the fire side and the EMS side. We're still seeing issues with substance abuse, and our Narcan administrations are up. On emergency management, the primary goal for emergency management is to identify areas of the community that are vulnerable and to prepare for disasters, whether they're natural or man-made, and to coordinate a response and also to assist in the recovery phase. And it's really important for us to do that, because in the event that we get a presidential disaster declaration, we're eligible for reimbursement. And generally, the way they work, it needs to be a record-breaking event. So I put a graph in here. For the last 10 years or so, I'm jumping around a little bit, sorry.
There you go.
Since 2001, we've received $1.2 million from FEMA due to mostly storm events. The highest one there included reimbursements for damages to utilities. Generally, for a snowstorm event, it's for snow removal efforts and for emergency response to it, so for police and fire overtime only. They change the rules on us each and every year, but the 2012 event, because of severe icing, also included a lot of money to the Reading Municipal Light Department. for, we just finished up our initial review of the package for the January 2015 snowstorms that we got. And they paid the disaster declaration, paid for the snow removal, emergency response, but also removal from the snow from roofs if it was a public safety issue. So the total anticipated amount we expect to receive is $189,000, $556. And the town share would be just a little over $173,000. It has to go through one more review process. They've really tightened up on the review process. So after the FEMA rep reviews it, it goes to somebody else for a quality control check. And so hopefully in a few months we'll see a check for that amount of money.
Excuse me, if you wanted to share, that would just drop into free cash?
Correct, because it's gone past the fiscal year, because it was last year's event.
Got it. And it would drop in, if it shows up before June, we'll see it in fiscal 16's.
Regeneration.
Yeah.
Okay. So the different town departments work really hard to make sure that we get what we're eligible for, and the DPW work really hard getting, making sure that they identify the cost that they're eligible. Same with the police department, fire, and also facilities department, and running light to make sure that we get what's eligible for. And when they do it, it could be a several day. Of plowing and things, but they generally give us a 48-hour window. So DPW picks the 48 most expensive hours, as everybody does, and that's how it goes in. So it's a portion of the cost, not the entire cost. And it's at 75% of what the eligible costs are. Mm-hmm. Moving on to the budget. Our staffing is projected to remain the same. We did the non-union pay by the town manager recommendations and the pay class process that was put into place. We're in the process of filling the assistant chief's position right now. It's already in this year's budget. On the captain's level, we have four captains moving a step this year. Three lieutenants moving a step, and we have nine firefighters moving a step. Next, we're going to be hiring three replacement firefighters, we're projecting. Could be two or three, depending upon how the assistant chief's position is filled. Three if it's an in-house position, two if it's not. We had a firefighter that resigned in July of 2015, and we're projecting. And we have a captain that's going to retire in December of 2016. On the expense budget, I moved some expenses around to reflect actual costs in specific areas. The biggest change is the ALS medical supplies budget. We increased that $7,000. We're seeing our costs for medications and disposal supplies continually go up. And so that's to capture what our actual spending is in that particular area. Our expense budget, our expense line item for ambulance billing is up slightly. We pay 4% of revenues, it was increased to reflect around an $800,000 revenue coming back to the community. Other expense budgets were moved around to reflect actual costs. That's one of the things that I wanted to touch upon. We're kind of unique in some of the departments around us, the other fire departments, is that we provide the emergency medical treatment and transportation, but we also bill for that. So we provide that at the advanced life support level. It's the highest level available. And we also put medical supplies on all our fire engines. So every truck that you see rolling has paramedic supplies on it. So when there's a paramedic on that truck, they're able to give medication. So we don't necessarily have to have an ambulance on scene to treat a patient. As long as we've got a fire truck on scene, we can treat a patient. And that's very unique to the communities around us. We registered the engine at our West Side Fire Station as an ambulance. It's a Class 5 ambulance. The engine that responds out of the downtown station and also the ladder truck are registered as Class 5 ambulances so they can carry those medications.
So a firefighter is paramedically trained, or a paramedic would be a separate role?
They're cross-trained.
Position.
They're
cross-trained.
Yeah, everybody, there's two levels of there's EMT basic.
Yeah.
It's actually true, but in our department it's two. There's EMT basic, and then there's EMT paramedic. And the paramedics are the ones that are staffing the ambulance, and they rotate. They'll do some time on a fire truck, they'll do a couple of months on a fire truck, then they'll do a couple of months on the ambulance, and they'll rotate. But everybody is certified to provide medical care. I just wanted to touch base on overtime. I kind of anticipated the question.
Would be a bunch of
only 10 years in a row.
This fiscal year was spent $352,000 in overtime, and we're trending lower than last fiscal year. We're about $36,000 less than last fiscal year, and what we did in May, we put on 4 new firefighters. And we trained them the month of May, and then we had them operational for the month of June. I sent two of them they have to go to the fire academy. I sent two of them to the academy in mid-July, and then I sent two in September. So they were all gone at the same time. I also had three injuries in the summertime, so we had very high overtime costs. I had savings in July because of the new firefighters. I had higher overtime costs in August, September, and October due to some injuries and those firefighters off being trained. Everybody was back to work late at the end of October, so I had lower overtime costs in November, December, January, and February. So we got hit harder in the beginning part, and now we're seeing the benefits of having people up to train.
And now it's a net down from last year.
And that's the reason why it's down from last year, is because once they came back from the academy and the injuries came back, then the overtime just dropped right off.
So is anyone out on disability now?
I have one fire lieutenant that's going through the retirement process, and I have one firefighter that's out short term. He's going to be back, I believe, the end of next week. A 2 week kind of issue.
Guys, in your packets on pages 14, 15, right through the end, Greg did a nice analysis of this and I wrote it up. So what was just discussed, kind of the last section on 15, last two paragraphs, are the discussion of the ups and downs.
Do you want me to go through the memos that I wrote?
I think you kind of just went through the first one. There are other questions about it. Each year we kind of look at this one because several years ago the overtime numbers just seemed so high above, you know, adding two, three, four new people, that it was worth doing an analysis. So Greg's been nice enough to do that analysis each year and see where, you know, where the break-even points are. And the conclusion from here was we're right staffed for the moment. Am I reading that right?
Well, actually, on a wage basis, I think if you hired one more firefighter, you'd save. But when you factor in things like benefit costs, that's
right.
Where it's present.
So fully loaded, yeah. It's still wrong. Wage
close.
Only.
Yeah,
it's at the edge. So it depends on how the coins flow.
Yeah, and the thing is with people being out, it's really dependent upon when they're out. Like I mentioned in the memo, somebody that's out January, February, and March has a much, if somebody's going to be out for a 3 month, say somebody's out for a 4 month period, if they're out in that time period, then it's less of an impact than if they're out in the summer. And if I have one injury and I have a group generally we're staffed on paper, because I've got a vacancy right now. We have four groups and four firefighter groups that work. One group is staffed at 12, the other is staffed at 3, at 11. So one at 12, three at 11. So if I have one injury, I could move the 12th person, cover that. So now they're all 4 and 11. So I don't have higher expenditures on a group that has an injury. But if I have two injuries out at the same time, I can only mitigate one of them. And that's kind of, so if you have two out at the same time during a peak vacation period, that hits you a lot harder than one in a time period where there's less vacation weeks.
The one that's going out on, or is on disability and is going to retire.
Yes.
Is that the one that we moved to the other part of the budget last year, or is that a different one?
That was three firefighters last year, as I recall.
Yeah.
And this year we're going to suggest moving one of the wages that have been incurred into that area.
Okay.
I think $70,000. You'll see that in the third week or second week for town meeting transfers.
Okay.
Isn't that the one he's referring to?
Yeah, again, to shift the cost of a firefighter who hasn't, you know, if you will, worked in his department for the whole fiscal year, but has been paid, so it's not productive use of his wages. It's really like a benefit.
Want to talk ambulance?
Sure. Yep, absolutely.
So the reason I keep probing on this one is I'm just trying to understand, and I know you are too, and I know you basically answered it, but the question was, are we charging appropriately for ambulance services compared to peer communities? Just to understand where we are. And kind of one of the follow-up questions that I only came up with today was, I understand the goal of having a community benefit. Are individuals mostly paying, or are insurance companies mostly paying? And I think it's probably a question for the people that are collecting the money, but unless you get some insight.
We get data back from that. And if you look at the revenue that we're receiving back from a Medicare and also workers' comp, is around 27% of our revenue coming back. In the data that I saw, I'm not sure what the percentage is right now of MassHealth. So, but that doesn't tell us what the percentage of our patients are. That's naturally kind of the key thing.
Right.
With ambulance billing, it's what your payer mix is. How many people have commercial insurance, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Tufts, and Elizabeth. And so what percentage of your patients have insurance? What percentage of your patients are on Medicare, and MassHealth and those things? Because that's just they'll only pay you 80% of their allowable, which is substantially less than what we charge, and what anybody charges. And it's really, doesn't really make up for what the cost is of providing that service. So that's really the key on what that mix is. And then the level of treatment that they receive, whether it's basic life support or advanced life support. So I looked at of the 26 communities that you gave us. I emailed out to those chiefs, and I haunted them as well. I got back information from 13 of them. And out of that, it showed that our rates were low in the basic life support level than the ALS 1 level. ALS 2 is a really critically injured patient, and nobody sees a lot of those patients. We might see 20, in the 20s, in the entire year. So it's not a big revenue number, but our ALS 2s were just a little bit above, you know, a small fraction above. So that didn't need to be adjusted. I also asked our ambulance vendor to give us some data back on ambulance billing. And they recommended going up, but the data that they gave back to us indicated we're kind of the comparable the communities that she gave. She did not identify what those communities were, but we were right in that average area. So there needs to be a little bit more study before, you know, we decide to go. And then there's also the question of, do we bundle the rates or do we not bundle the rates?
Right. Yeah, and again, it's, and you mentioned, you know, it's something to be discussed kind of for January timeframe, which is great. My question was, if it turns out that there's 15% comfortably still with a buffer, that's $100,000, roughly $125,000, you know. So it's material. It's not a small piece. It's just something we should look at.
Yeah, it could.
The problem with looking at things like ambulance fees by themselves is that you really need to look at fees for the whole organization on a regular basis, and we do. But it's an enormous amount of work to look at all your fees for 25 communities or even five. Realistically, we could probably do that every 5 years. We last did it about 4 years ago. And it comes down to a situation where, you know, you could have two neighbors and one of them just paid more in ambulance fees and the other one paid less because we're low on something that they all know.
Right.
So you really have to do it kind of as a bundle, I think, to be fair. It's pretty easy to pick a couple things out. The depot is another one. You know, $25 to park at the train station is a pretty good deal. That doesn't really have a peer number, but some of them you can do one off, but generally you're better off kind of looking at fees broadly.
Yeah.
And quite often, I just ask the department heads, I don't want you to look at all your fees. You have a sense of what fees are too high or too low. It's usually not too many too high. So, you know, we do that, but we need to sort of do it as a package. And generally the selectmen try to look at it in early fall.
Yeah.
Because some of the fees, many of the fees go January 1st.
Yeah. Well, I think it all makes sense. I think one of the questions I had related to ambulance was, I would guess that the vast majority of the payments come through some form of insurance company as opposed to individuals writing checks. Could be proven right or wrong, but if that was true, the impact of a change in the rate isn't hitting individuals so much. That was the question.
Well,
makes our health insurance rates go up, though.
It depends on what they have for insurance, because you know, people have deductibles and things. So,
right. So the first X really comes out of everybody's pocket. This approach, I think, is exactly right. We should be looking at these things on a regular basis and see what they look like and see what their opportunities. But before I say that, Barry, you
have... No, I was just... Bob had just said it. You know, on the board, we're going to be looking... You know, as we kind of plow through what FY18 looks like, we're going to be looking at fees, all fees. Are we charging the right fees? Are there things that we're missing? So it's going to be part of a whole comprehensive piece that the board's going to look at going forward. So, and this is a piece of it. So,
right, but there's something to be said as we see opportunities like this, so that it doesn't all come at once, so that all of a sudden the community doesn't increase all their fees. So if we see an opportunity, I think we should take advantage of it.
Yeah, but I mean, how many people are going to get a parking sticker and use the ambulance and, you know, take out a building permit? I mean,
word spreads quick to go, oh my gosh, we have to work with it, you know.
Yeah.
So I hate to see opportunities go by that we could be raising some revenue as appropriate.
Just bear in mind, fees are set based on your cost. So even if you have an opportunity, you can't necessarily justify it because she'll get mad.
Yeah, but to the point Greg just made, we're seeing additional costs for materials and budget increases.
Yeah.
So there are some costs, hard costs that we're seeing, you know, that aren't in the rate yet, conceivably. Anyway, we're all saying the same thing. We need to be looking at all the opportunities and see which ones make sense. And so I'm going to go through a process of that, so that's okay. Sorry, I kind of been hogging the stage. Anybody else want to?
Okay.
No?
Good.
Thanks, Greg.
Thanks, Greg.
Good evening, Chief. Too. You notice I brought the blue book. He's got the rubber. Thanks for having me here tonight. As you know, I stepped into this role December 30th, so whatever you like in the budget, I'll take credit for it. What you don't like, blame my predecessor. All right? All right, here we go. Reading Police Department, request for fiscal year 17 is requested at $5,361,400, or 4.4% when compared to FY16. Over 95% of the budget is spent on personnel. Our department is made up of three components, patrol, which is the majority of what you people see on a day-to-day basis on the road, investigations, and support services. Support services is the school resource officer, safety officer, our armorer, our training department, and our parking enforcement officer, who you see as well on a regular basis on the square area. In FY 17, the budget request for the police department budget for 42 officers. This is the same amount as FY 16. Two civilian office employees, a civilian part-time parking enforcement officer,
64.
One full-time and one part-time ICASAR people as well. The salary lines meet all contractual agreements in direction regarding non-union compensation. This would include steps and coordinates adjustments. I had asked for an additional school resource officer, which I believe is a valuable tool. I understand as of this year, when the town manager does not want to put forward expenses. The expenses are up approximately 7.4% in the department expense budget. We are currently in negotiation with the town of Northray to regionalize the animal control officer function. This has been $50,000 set aside for this regionalization. The police training budget up at a request of $17,000 is the right side of this to the current cost of training. Over the past 3 years, the average cost of training has been of $18,500. It is vital that we keep our officers up to date on law changes and current police techniques. Some of the other adjustments and categories have been made in an attempt to actively predict costs. If you want to go through line by line. Okay. The lieutenants and the sergeants increases of 7.1 to 5.1 are contractual. We hired six sergeants over the past two years, and out of those, they're all on steps, so that's all because of step increases right there. If you look at the 40%, which is the parking enforcement officer, he's going from 18 to 25 hours a week. We believed that we needed a little bit of additional more time spent on parking enforcement. And himself, he's actually, the animal control officer was taken out of this budget. $50,000 was put into the expense side at this point for North Reading. The police school traffic has a significant increase. That's because of steps in a, because of the paying class study. They have gone up a step, and an actual classification change was done as well for this next budget with the parking crossing guards.
Are these officers or are these the crossing guards?
No, those are the crossing guards. Yes, you see at the school crossing guards every day, 9 months a year, 9.5 months a year. All the way down to the expense side, we'll show the, let's see. The training, it shows the training at $17,000. Again, that's the right size of the budget. And let's see, that's what I basically got for you tonight. Any questions, concerns, I can tell you out of the police side, and we can go to the dispatch side right afterwards.
So one question, what is the, if there were to be another school resource officer, what's the cost?
It's approximately $90,000.
That's with benefits?
$80,000 without benefits. And that primary responsibility of that officer would be more into the middle schools. Right now, I think we really do a great job in the high school. We don't do as good a job in the middle schools and the elementary as we could. We're there on a daily, well, a weekly basis, but I think we could use more time into the middle schools, getting to the kids at a younger age.
When you say there on a weekly basis, is that the middle schools or even down to the elementary schools?
Even that, well, elementary probably once a week to some of them, not every one of them, but the middle school is definitely once a week, but the high school is a daily constant thing.
Was that a request last year too? I'm trying to remember, a second resource officer. I know we had the conversation last year,
definitely.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Did we hear from the school as a
Oh, they'd love another one. I think it was an issue of if it was going to be proposed by the schools or by the police department. I think that was a discussion we had last year with Jim.
Dispatch, Dispatch. The Reading Police Department dispatch for FY 17 is funded at $565,150, 5.3% increase compared to FY 16. Again, over 95% of this budget is spent on personnel. dispatch company staff with 10 civilian telecommunicators and one civilian head dispatcher who work several shifts per week as a telecommunicator and oversees the administration of the dispatch center. In addition to town funding, $50,000 in 911 grants are used to offset existing salaries. This grant is not guaranteed and can be discontinued by the state at any time. Salary lines are meeting all contractual agreements and direction regarding non-union compensation. This would include step and COLA increases. Expenses is up 2.6% to 25.5. Dispatch has gone through major changes in the past staffing in the last past few years. In addition, the town has increased the overall staffing levels, which has caused an increase in initial uniform and training costs as well for the dispatch center.
Right, because we had an extra one last year.
Correct. Yeah, actually, we did. We added two extra last year. Yeah. And now we're staffed fully at two. Actually, we're down one right now. We're hiring a second one. It's out right now. It's been on the paper. We're looking to fill a second position. But right now we have one full. We have two dispatchers on the first half, which is the 4 to midnight shift. Two on the midnight shift, and two on the day shift. Or three on the day shift. When people are not on vacation or sick time or anything. Used to be just one dispatcher on every midnight shift, and we found that just really was starting to be too busy and wasn't enough of one person to handle all the time.
It's great that I was able to fund that last year.
Absolutely, yeah.
It's a lot of pressure.
It absolutely is, right. And we've had it at times, we've had to call in someone in an emergency right away from home to help out because it's that something going on, it's an extended car accident or some type of emergency overnight. So, all the officers are on the road. The officers obviously will help out when they can, but if they need it on the road, they got to be on the road. So,
questions?
Cool. Thank you.
Nice job.
Thank you.
Quick as possible. I've got some handouts here. I'll keep that up. Okay. So I thought I'd talk about the, everybody knows the facilities department. I've been in the town of Reading for the last 10 years now, and we've moved the facilities department, like Bob said earlier. And location is still at the high school. We still operate out of the field house in the back, but we now are a town department split up into three separate areas. We've got the core facilities budget, which is the money used to maintain all of the school and town buildings, including the utilities, the maintenance staff, myself, the assistant director, and the secretary at facilities. That's where we do all the repair work, preventive maintenance, everything involved in the physical plant of all the buildings. We also have a separate budget that's under my control, which is the town building budget, which is the town side custodial staff, as well as the cleaning contracts to clean the, there's four municipal buildings that's done under contract, as well as the cleaning supplies associated with doing that work. And then there's a similar budget, which is not mentioned up here, which is the school budget, which is all the school custodians, which is around 23 people, custodians cleaning, as well as the cleaning contracts and the cleaning supplies to do the eight school buildings. We're responsible for eight school buildings and nine municipal buildings. This year we had two buildings added to the inventory, which is the Matera Cabin and the cemetery garage, which is up in Laurel Hill across the street here. There are some increases in our budget this year, largely due to some maintenance contracts that we for our HVAC controls package is in all of our buildings except the DPW garage. We just ended a warranty period after our performance contracting initiative, and we needed to address and have an ongoing preventive maintenance contract in all of the school and town buildings. Along with that, we had some increases in our plumbing and electrical expense lines at all the buildings. We actually have a master plumber and a master electrician that work for the town, and we're doing more and more of that work in-house, so the actual expenses for the supplies and things of that nature in both of those areas went up, but the contracted labor went down because we're utilizing our in-house people. So getting back into the, I don't know if you can go to the first slide there.
Want to go backwards?
Yeah, right there. So this just mentions the department key functions that that the facilities department is responsible for, and performing routine maintenance repairs of all of 17 buildings, managing supporting the preventive maintenance program. We utilize a preventive maintenance program, it's called School Do, which we use for our town and school buildings. We have a preventive maintenance and a work order system and a critical alarm automation system that integrates all of the controls, work orders, low temperature alarms, all into this package that that we're working with every day to assign work orders, track repairs, and things of that nature. Also, we do coordination of outside contractors, handle all the state mandated inspections and scheduling for all the different life safety systems in the buildings. We handle the capital planning and project management and implement the capital plan for all the buildings in the town of Reading. And we manage the custodial and the service of all the town and school buildings. That chart below there basically is showing you the integration with the computerized maintenance management software and how it kind of all ties together. We're able to track expenses. If we had a boiler go down, hopefully tonight I don't have one go down, but if we did, I do get a work order in the middle of the night and an alarm comes in on my phone and I can get on my computer, my laptop, and I can go into each building and I can see a problem. During the cold snap we had 2 weeks ago, that was a really key feature. We did have a couple of issues in the buildings, but had we hadn't had that, it would have been much more costly for the town buildings and a couple of the schools. So it works, and we're heavily invested in this this system that we have.
In the future, as you said, the warranty period versus performance do you see that continuing to be more warranties ending in the next few years, or is it fading up?
We had a contract with a controls company that we were doing more or less a time and materials contract, and I was calling them in as we needed them. But we realized that that wasn't enough. We have, yeah, we really, we're doing with 90% of the other contracts, we give them a certain amount of hours every year to come in and maintain our boilers and our rooftop equipment. We saw that with the controls, we really need to have somebody out here once a month going through and just recalibrating the systems to make sure that everything's running properly. And it's all tied back into our savings that were, you know, with Noresco, because they do measurement and verification every year. And if we're not maintaining the equipment and proving that we're following a good preventive maintenance program, they won't guarantee savings. It hasn't happened, but so that's another reason why we needed to jump into a service agreement with this local vendor we're using. The big difference this year in our staffing is we're gonna be hopefully filling the assistant director position in the next couple of months. And there'll be an addition to of a town custodian that we've been interviewing last week, which will be, this person will be stationed at the Reading Public Library when the library is completed. So we'll have a full-time person in there at night and a day person over there.
Can we cross-train them on digital technology as well?
Believe it or not, most of our maintenance staff is actually well-versed in running the controls package. We have guys that can actually run it, and a few of the custodians actually can do it also in the buildings. So, any questions?
All good. I just have a comment. It's behind the scenes, so you don't see it, but Joe especially and Jane to a lesser degree have spent an enormous amount of time on the Reading Public Library project over the last 2 years. We hired a full-time project manager, and you absolutely need one, but for Jane and procurement and Joe, I'm sure you have not worked a day in at least the last year where you have not done something with the library. So probably a quarter or a third of Joe's time is on that project. On top of the water, it's just like my old boss said, a firm named Gansner used to say, which was a duck.
looks nice and smooth on the top, but down, look down below, look at the feet, working like crazy. Project on the top looks great. Done a lot of hard work to keep things online, and I'm sure Joe will be greatly relieved when that project is done, just getting back to more or less full-time facilities. So it's been a luxury to have him and Jane help us with it. The town doesn't do very many building projects. The last big one was the high school. We're still dealing with the after effects. Let's hope we've all learned a lesson from that. And you know, if we're going to go forward with other capital projects, it's a serious consideration to make sure you're staffed up. You can't just assume away time as we've given from or taken from Jane and Joe especially.
Are you guys involved with the permanent building committee as either full-time members?
Joe goes all the time.
Yeah, I go to all the meetings. Yeah.
Great
group.
Yeah, good, really good group.
Padding facts, I think facilities in Paris to 10, 15 years ago, which is unbelievable how much
they are.
Thank you.
And the savings you've seen. I mean, it's just it's amazing.
Thanks.
Thanks, Joe. So just to recap for next week, you'll hear from Public Services, Public Works, and the Public Library. And Public Works will include the enterprise funds, which shouldn't take too long. So next week's probably a little shorter agenda if you need to build something else into it. If you'd like, it probably is a good idea for me to preview the upcoming town meeting warrant, especially the budget transfers for FY16. Right now, we're looking at spending $100,000 in free cash and assuming the snow and ice has no impact. It probably has. Oh, I'm not even going to say.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not going to say another word. we have a lot of different things moving around, but for only $100,000 in free cash or $150,000, it's not too bad. And a couple of significant requests you'll see involve the superintendent and myself in facilities, so we'll get to that next week. That way you have time to ask him questions when he comes in the third week, and I may attend that also because they are joint expenses proposed. And then in the fourth week, you'll be asked to vote on those. And I think this year we have a pretty good idea, absent snow and ice, that all the numbers are good. Sometimes you can't help but adjusting on town meeting floor. We may have that, but we'll see. I don't think there's any other significant financial articles on town meeting. There's certainly some to vote on, like moving money from the OPEB line item to the OPEB trust and so forth, but nothing that you won't be very familiar with.
At one of the meetings, can we take a look at status on capital projects? Just get updates, and key issue being where are there things that are very different from expectations? So we know something's got deferred.
Probably next week's a good time because most of it's Jeff.
Okay.
That would be Road and such.
Any other questions for these guys?
Just got me thinking, we're adding security to certain buildings. What does that usually come under? Is that usually capital?
You'll see next week.
Oh.
The superintendent and I and several people here have been meeting on building security. Let's just say it's a broad topic. And the request you'll see at town meeting will be to hire an independent consultant, which is not easy to find, to actually study options town-wide and school-wide. So I don't remember the dollar figure, I tell you, but it's not insignificant.
And that's just for the consultant?
And that would just be to the consultant to prepare you for, here are some options, and here's what it's going to cost. I will tell you that it's very likely that the security costs that come out will be in seven figures, just so you know. You know, the consultant won't be nearly that much, but that is easy to see $1 million plus. And it really is a question of where the comfort level of this community is with different options and different features. And comfort's in two ways. One is lack of privacy, lots of cameras, and one is lots of cameras to, you know, cover safety. So it's a tough discussion, but I think we can't really advance that discussion very far till we know what our options are, which is why we thought getting a consultant would be good. And we've had the benefit of a free consultant for the last year. One of the mutual funds in towns as part of community services has a resident who's an expert on this, but we've really used up about as much of his expertise that doesn't get into the and now recommend something for us, because he doesn't want to do that, but he's been really helpful meeting with us
the chief regularly. So that is one of the items you'll hear a lot more about next week, and then you can follow up with John in the third week.
Maybe the old chief is bored. He wants to.
No, he's busy. He's already working.
Is he really?
Yeah.
Any other questions for the group here, for the department heads? No? Thank you, guys.
Yeah,
you're more than
you.
Welcome to stay for a continuation of our meeting. But
just take a 2-minute break.
Yeah, yeah. Everybody kind of.
Yeah, it is.
Just electronically, but
that's
in an
fine.
Email.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just want to make sure I've got it.
Yeah, by all means check. But yeah, I did. Sometimes they don't always label it differently if it's the same, and I think this year it was unchanged. And again, their budget is $125,000 over what funds were available. That's another item that will come up as a capital request. I'm sorry, it's not capital, it's a request for a April town meeting.
Or what will they present to us? Does their budget as approved?
They'll probably present the entire budget, including $125,000 request for curriculum. And I've asked John to ask for that at April town meeting in the current fiscal year, and then his budget balances, and he gets a jump on buying the curriculum. So it just made sense.
All right. Let's discuss a couple things. One is we can talk a little bit more about the fact sheets today, or we can push that off to next week because it sounds like we got a little bit more time next week, and that would allow me to actually have my homework done. I don't know if anybody else is in the same situation.
Some of my homework, so I could pass that one at least because it takes some input.
Please, that'd be great.
So I was the one that was called 2.5, but I just wanted to really make it sort of a very high level considering revenue creating expense challenge because I'm So I was trying to take a lot of the information that Bob already had, but I tried to narrow it down at a higher level and just show the constraints we have in revenue, that so much of it falls on the local property taxes, and a big reason for that is the decreases in state aid. And that as a individual, the property tax burden is also increased because new growth is not what our peer communities see. It's lower than the rest of our peer communities. And this was just to address the revenue question or the revenue constraint. In terms of expenses, I didn't know the easiest way. I was trying to come up with just some top bullets of issues we've seen, and obviously something like benefits would be a big piece. So I was trying to make it similar, sort of the before and now, because I liked how you did that in the book, how you sort of showed the time of the previous override. So it sort of goes from FY24 jumps to 16-17 to show the, before and after.
You know, since we last met and would have discussed this, I looked at FY03 spending, which is before the override, FY04 spending, which is after the override, compared to the FY17 budget. The only number I remember is after the override, so since 04 to this budget, annualized, the school and the town budgets are up identically 3.1% a year, within decimal points of that. So effectively, the shape we're in today, for better or worse, has arisen from spending 3% a year since the override.
Yeah.
So you can judge when going forward, is that adequate, is that not adequate?
It's probably not adequate, but it's probably not dramatic enough to sort of highlight an issue.
Right.
So I was thinking take
over. But the 3% that the schools in the town have spent, you know, are less as a percent of the budget because of health insurance,
exactly.
Certainly.
Exactly. That's the point. I was just trying to take out some piece
but,
that shows the challenge.
But interestingly, if you forget the fact there's excluded debt and all that, mm-hmm. and you just look at money being spent, the increase in benefits has been more than offset by the decrease in debt service. 10 years ago, before I got here, we were spending a lot of money on debt. Mm-hmm. You remember doing all the elementary schools inside the tax levy, mostly. And now we are much more prudent, and we tend to issue shorter debt, so there's less interest costs. So the savings in the debt approach, while it's not really fair to say, we haven't had any new capital projects that were financed with debt inside the levy, basically. And that has allowed the expense growth to happen in benefits.
Right, so we're not going to continue.
So schools and towns have actually not been that significantly affected only for that reason. Mm-hmm. But going forward, that mm-hmm. tool doesn't exist anymore. You can't eliminate any more debt service that's not there. So.
And the other thing that seems, I'd have to worry about that, that's been more manageable than, let's say, and this is just anecdotally, the special education, because it seems like
yeah.
5 to 7 years ago, the special education costs were just out of control.
10 years ago, they were double digits.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I know he's made a concerted effort over the recent period to in-house insource a lot
right.
of that. It's better for the students as well as the budget, mm-hmm. at a cost to his budget, but then net, it's better. You're right, though, that special ed inflation, if you will, partly for that reason, is lower. Now we think 5-6% a year. It used to be 12-14.
Yeah. It was
back with Harry, it was, you know, well into double digits. And that's true about the industry, not just Reading.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's trouble when you have the town manager suddenly looking at a lot of data, trying to figure out things. Next week, or maybe in 2 weeks, I got to look at it some more. There's a new website that has put a lot of interesting data available that would be really right up your alley, but Sharon and I looked at it, and the quality's not perfect. And it's really dangerous to start making conclusions. I mean, I'll give you a real simple example. Reading has a 370% unemployment rate in the last year. Huh?
What?
That's what it says. I assume it's 3.7. So the graph over time looks, you can barely see it, and all of a sudden it jumps up there. It's like, if no one's doing that kind of basic quality control on data, what else is going on in here? So, and they ignore our stabilization fund when they look at reserves. So they only look at free cash. Other communities, they definitely include stabilization. So I'm always reluctant to put that stuff out there because of those issues, but it's really such a good resource. No. No, it's pulling from the DOR, because a lot of the work they did, and I wish I had seen it sooner, I did by hand, well, through the DOR.
Mm-hmm.
So remember all those charts about peer communities. I could have used this as a resource and got more information. For instance, the thing I couldn't find they have, which is per household income, which I would have loved to have found. So it's a really nice resource, and it was sent in an email to me designed for FinComs. I really needed to look at it before I just gave it to you and see how accurate it was, because I'd just done a lot of the work. And it is good. And I think you may be able to find some interesting background information, but you got to just be careful.
Mm-hmm.
You can't always leap to a conclusion based on the quality of the data.
So what was the purpose for this, actually, for the two and a half? What did you want to see?
Well, Mark had that list of...
Yeah, no, I remember that. So
that one was basically to talk to, you know, in the clearest way possible to address what challenges we're seeing on the revenue side and on the expense side. So the revenue side, I felt like there was more of a story there. On the expense side, to come up with just really a high-level driver to some of the problems we're seeing. You know, it's like, okay, so we're growing 3%.
Mm. Right, so the way I read this chart is, you know, obviously revenues from property taxes increase, aid has decreased, and then But then are we missing half of the picture here in terms of
revenue.
The expense?
Expenses.
So what are we looking at, all the expenses or just benefits or
I was just trying
services?
To
help
with goals. Interesting ones.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Just highlights, because this is really high level when the average person in town asks the question to be able to.
Where does the money go?
Yeah, or just why we feel we're concerned right now.
Maybe the hammer point on this is state aid, where it used to be 25%. Yeah, and I'm wondering if there's a way to really highlight that. I think saying it's declined 50% since 03 is not, it's not kind of hitting me hard enough. I mean, it's true, but I'm wondering if there's a way to just kind of.
If it hadn't, you'd have another $6 million a year. How's
that kind of thing. That kind of thing.
That,
right. Yeah. So that the real level of state aid has just crunched dramatically, and our real costs have gone the other way. And so when people are saying, well, why does it have to come from taxes?
A couple of costs, right? I mean, if you're looking bullet points again, and you try to quantify it that way, and you say that lost state aid is $6 million, you quantify what the health insurance increase on the cost side.
You can actually stop right there with those.
That's what I mean, right? You know, I mean,
that tells the whole story.
Quick hitters, and you stop right there.
Exactly.
People can read two bullet points.
Yeah, I think that's the right way to do it. Just hit it. Just
right.
Yeah.
Look, there's nothing.
Way down,
it's not
way
a confusing
out.
Story.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I think that's a great way to show it. And you know, at the end of the day, people are saying, "Geez, what? You know, isn't there another way to pay for this stuff?" Right. And then we're kind of saying, "Well, state aid is gone."
I think new growth is another one that's important to highlight too.
Comparative. Yeah. Versus other people. Versus the average. The pieces that you've got there.
Yeah. I know the only tricky part, because I did include, like, the tricky part is the average person doesn't get
what that is.
Right.
So it's always hard trying to appeal to the average person. It's a big piece, and so I did want to include it, and yet.
It's relatively simple to say we don't have a lot of vacant land to develop compared to our neighbors.
Yeah, but I understand typically
that
new growth is.
Well. There's a lack of opportunity to expand the tax base. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, that's
well,
fairly basic.
2.5 really comes out at 3.1.
Yeah.
You get a little bit more than 2.5, but not a lot. So.
Yeah.
So do you have feel for what benefits have?
I have it back in my office, but not in my head. And it's benefits. It's not just the health part. It's the whole package. So I did look at that 03, 04, and Karen, I just don't remember. I just remember it went the opposite direction of the debt service.
So that was good news today. They got 5 then?
Yeah. Yeah, better than 12.
You're including the funding for OPEB and retirement.
Yep. Yep.
And were we funding retirement?
Not as aggressively back then.
So it wasn't mandatory?
Oh, we were funding it, but not at 4.5% increases every year. It was like 2 or 2.5. But we were funding retirement.
So was the 2% targeting to be fully funded at some point? Or was that more like a voluntary?
No, it was by law by then.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had to. We didn't have a choice.
So are you thinking you're going to just streamline this down to a few points and that's the end?
Basically.
Yeah.
I think the revenue is basically the benefits.
Yep. I have a broad question to throw out there. There's a lot of background work being done on long-term finances, as you might guess. And you don't have to answer this now, but think about what you think as a FinCom. A good long-term target level for an operating budget of the town and the school is for the next 10 years or 15 years or whatever. What's a good target? You've seen what we've done recently. We've done 2.75 up to 3.6 or something like that for the last 5 years. So think about, because that'll be a key decision point in setting the amount of an override if we go for one, is what are we trying to accomplish? given a bunch of assumptions that will never be perfect. And the other question I may as well ask you is, what should you use for health insurance inflation? I happen to use 7.5, which that's an enormous variable. If you make it 6 or you make it 10, it's multiple millions of dollars difference over 15 years. And I just finally said a couple weeks ago, 7.5 close enough. Who knows? I don't know. You know, what do you guys use? Yeah. Yeah, 1.
Yeah, that's not really a long-term plan.
But those are the two decision points that are really have a lot of influence over the long-term math that I can think of.
I think it's sort of hard for us to come up with the operating.
Yeah.
Based on requirements.
Yeah, John and I will have a sense of that, but. And that means, you know, if you're going to do an override, presumably there's more or less two parts to it. One is something to restore something you don't have. So there's some first step, whatever it is, of any size. And then from there, given the best information you have, how long do you want the override to help you before you need another one? And at what level do you need help? You know?
In the past, you've indicated that, you know, 10% is worth the trouble. 2% certainly isn't.
For the amount of an override?
Yeah.
Yeah. Less than 5 is not worth it.
Yeah. So is there some way that with the existing debt servicing costs that we have for the library and everything else that can be built into the
10% rather? I've come up with 8 scenarios going out to 2030 so far. And I may as well tell you, 3 of them change the amount after the debt service is repaid for the high school and library. So just as a simple example, you have a 10% override, but you only assess 5% of it until that debt's paid, and then you add the other 5. That's just a very logical thing to do. But it takes a certain amount of trust on the public that the selectmen will do that until the debt is repaid, because by law, they've just given them the authority to set the tax rate at a higher amount and not to leave millions of dollars on the table every year. So. You know, that is a political pressure. This board would be fine with it, but you're talking about boards into the future also.
And the beauty of that is that the question for the override is a simple one.
Right.
It doesn't have to be, okay, we're going to do 5% now, and then in 5
exactly.
years it goes, you know, it changes to this.
Right.
Could you say you're going to do 10 and incorporate the debt within 10?
That you could do that as well, but that gets complicated. I was thinking about how you do it, and it's too complicated. But you could bring the debt inside the tax levy. What you wouldn't want to do is bring it inside the tax levy and then not have an override pass. Then you'd really be in trouble.
So you can't make a conditional on that?
No. So you could do that after an override, and it would effectively remove the element of trust. You know, if you don't trust the selectmen, bring the high school and the library debt inside the tax levy. It's now excluded. Rather than just trust the selectmen to do something, you could actually say to the voters, haul it back inside the tax, and then we'll do the full 10% or whatever the number is.
Yeah,
so that's another thing.
Out in the year 8 or whatever it is, we have a lot of debt roll off, but you probably have problems after year 5.
Well, it's the same effect as if you trust the selectmen or...
Yep.
Don't trust them and then have the voters bring it in. It's the same math.
Yep.
I just think that, you know, if the trust is not a problem, that's much simpler to explain. Not, by the way, in another 6 months or a year, we're going to have you vote again to do this other thing. It's just a lot simpler. But either would work and thus have the same effect. And the other thing you need to think about, we potentially have some, you know, for instance, the DPW garage, significant projects that would normally be excluded debt. Is there a promise made about keeping that inside the levy, which goes against some of your policies? So, you know, some of your policies will have to be reviewed in this regard.
But I think one of the things that highlights is we need to have a kind of a 10-year look on everything that we anticipate. Everything. So,
yeah.
I mean, I think at the Board of Selectmen meeting, you had a pile of notes that had come in from various people.
Oh, yeah.
Discussing... overrides and
responses
to the financial forum in some cases too. There was like 54 pages of things that came in. with comments, but a number of the comments were, you know, hey, why is this following on the library? And why didn't we kind of see a full picture? And why, you know, when we got to vote, why didn't we see there's the library, there's this, there's this, there's this? And I think one of the things we're going to need to do is make sure that we've laid out what we reasonably anticipate in total. And using an approach like the 10% bump allows that, right? It allows saying, okay, yeah, it's this because it's incorporating these things. And other than that, other than unexpected boiler explosions and things, this sounds pretty reasonable. I think that'll help people a lot. And just, I tried to read through the notes to see kind of what the tone was. You know, a lot of them were just kind of, you know, supportive of, hey, you know, schools, this is crazy. And others were, again, why wasn't this planned out better? Mm-hmm. You know, I just got hit, now you're gonna hit me again. Mm. They're supportive, but they're kind of saying it would have been nicer if you had looked at it.
Yeah, it's a little frustrating.
It's a lot frustrating.
We brought it up and brought it up. How much can you get it out there saying,
yeah,
this wasn't a surprise to any of us.
Right.
Like, yeah. It might have been to people who weren't keyed in, but
right,
you know, we struggled with that because we also knew other expenses at the time. We thought it was going to be a big school proposal for, you know,
right,
pre-K.
Yep.
And
right,
we got out lucky there. We knew there were back-to-back projects.
Again, I think the clearer and simpler the information that we can share with everybody, the more likely people can digest it and then ask their questions.
And I will jump to one conclusion, which won't be a surprise, but it's very disheartening, is whatever scenario you look at that's reasonable, the amount of an override you need to add new things is so big, you can't do it. And I mean big, big things that you want to add. If you mean an override to sustain you for 10 or 15 years, you need a big number to do that and do nothing extra than nothing new. Again, we're looking at a 0.8% operating budget next year without any help. Things may change. They probably will. It'll probably get better. But to bring that up into the threes, that's a lot of money.
Right.
And to do that consistently year over year over year is a lot of money. So one of the messages that'll be really important to get to the community soon is that this override is not meant to add a lot of new things. It's meant to maintain what you have now and maybe add just a couple of things. And having that bump, you know, out in 5 or 6 or 7 years, I've actually played with a stabilization fund to smooth the whole thing, so it's not a bump at all. It's a bump in revenues, but we're either saving money or spending money out of the stabilization fund to just have 10 or 15 years of straight operating budget, same every year. You know that won't happen, but it's better planning that way.
Well, and would you really want to put it in the stabilization if you need the two-thirds, or would you put it in?
It has to be somewhere. I mean, yeah, probably. It could be. But, you know, I will tell you that with a 15% override, you don't get a budget of 4% a year. Nowhere's close.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's the extra bump? A half a point?
You'd have to have a 25% override before you hit like 4%. It's phenomenal. No, it really is.
That answers the first question.
You know, the fundamental disconnect of expenses and revenues, again, it's not like a one-term problem and then you solve it. It's every year you expect, yeah, our costs to be higher because of things like health insurance and the fact our revenues are constrained. So you're not just trying to sort of climb up a ladder and then it's all fixed. It's like every year it's going to get a little worse. So every year you have to solve it. And the further you go out, the harder it is to do that.
So,
but there was an override in Bourne last fall that I think generally people thought would pass. And the reason it failed by a very narrow margin is because it was targeted to only solve the problem for 5 years. And they said that, and it was not a small number. So there's a lot of considerations.
Sorry, I'm going in circles in my head. Maybe you can help me square the circle. I mean, ooh, you're a taxpayer. You say, what do I care about healthcare? What does that mean? So it goes back to services with service. So shouldn't some of the expenses show, you know, if you have kids and you put your kids to school, what's the expense on the school side and on the,
yeah,
public services side rather than showing benefit? Because benefit on,
yeah,
its own doesn't mean anything. If I'm actually, mm-hmm,
it's not getting you anything, right?
Why? What does it mean? So,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The only thing I think it does, people can relate to it because everyone experiences higher increases in their health care for example.
True, but again.
So I think they can relate to it, that that's a pressure that the town's under. Is it a benefit to them? No, but they go, oh, yeah, right.
No, it's taking away from the benefit to them.
But that's.
If we've got to spend that on healthcare, those are dollars that aren't being spent on.
And because we're not necessarily talking about putting something new and exciting in the budget, I think it's challenging to try and. It's hard to put the carrot out there in front of them if there's no carrot.
Yeah, I think so. I agree.
But I would say, whose healthcare are you talking about? And then you say, well, the people who does this and this and that, or like, well, why do we need them to do this and this and that?
How many?
That's what I'm trying to get out.
Yeah, how large do you want your class size to be is the answer.
Right, or do you want to apply your own street?
Right, so that's what I mean. Shouldn't we concentrate on those expenses rather than benefits?
Well, certainly, you know, it'd be silly to even imagine an override without some addition of services. We all have to agree with that. But the bigger discussion point is the services that'll be lost without one over time. So, you know, I don't know how you project that. That's a question that John and I haven't really talked about a lot. But, you know, in theory, if we had no override for the next 10 years, how many teachers could he afford is a fair question. I don't know the answer. He could figure it out. We could make some assumptions, figure it out. Class size would go from 23 to 38 or whatever it would do. I don't know. You know, I'm just saying those numbers. I don't know the answer. You could do that, though. You know, how beneficial is such a wild guess with a lot of assumptions to the community? I don't know. But I tell you, the longer you stretch a time period out, the scarier any number you look at gets, or the any result.
And some ways you have to be careful with your assumptions then, not make them so dire. Because who would have thought?
I've tried that. Yeah, I really have. You know, the regular thing we look at for balance or expenses and revenues, I've just worked that out to 2030 and showed Sharon, and she says you're reasonable, you know, what the annualized assumptions are. It's all a guess, but, you know, the revenues are ended up right around 3%. I can't remember exactly. Maybe not quite without any override. And, again, health insurance at 7.5 is a big assumption, and the rest are all reasonable. I mean, you know, you could always argue, but nothing unusual.
Hopefully inflation doesn't go up.
Yeah.
Well, maybe for that reason, have to make it more aggressive.
Well, I tried 6 and I tried 8 or 9. It's a huge difference. So there's no right answer there. So what do you do? I don't know.
What is the percentage of benefits of the budget again? Is it 10 or?
Yeah, and the rest, the other 90% are not growing at an unpredictable rate like that. And we don't have 10% of our revenues that could grow to match it. That's what I always wanted to do when I was on FinCom, is couldn't we just assign some revenue to take care of that problem? And the answer is no. All the revenues go up at 3%. And 90% of your expenses go up at 3%. That doesn't solve the problem.
So the other piece that is highlighted here is that every taxpayer in the state, but in the town, should be screaming at their legislators.
Yeah.
Saying you're killing us. There's no way.
The answer to that is they have to raise the income tax rate.
Well, so.
And they have health insurance costs.
Down?
Well, no,
it hasn't.
But that's the reason state aid has been cut is because the income tax rate is cut.
How much has it come down? It's come down a half point?
Five when that, it was up over 6, and now it's down just over 5.
5. Okay.
It's close to a point, I think.
And how much is coming?
Sales tax went up.
Yeah, sales tax went up. And how much of our state aid comes from lottery?
It doesn't technically anymore. It used to.
Cool.
But how much really is it?
Well, you saw in that chart that the only category they're spending more on is health, just like us. But it's not just the health insurance of their employees. It's health insurance much more broadly, like mass health, you know, for residents. So health insurance, you think it's bad in Reading, it's much worse at the state level for what they're attempting to do. Not all of it, it's their choice, but they also feel it's their obligation. But when that's gone up, whatever it was, 50 or 60% over that period of time, nothing else has gone up at all. Everything has slipped. It just so happens that state aid is the worst.
I
Anybody else do their homework? Hand out?
Okay.
We'll take care of that. Why don't we put this on the agenda for next week to spend some more time talking about it? And I think I couldn't go to the 23rd meeting, but it sounds like the selectmen are starting to put more thinking together.
Yeah, if you folks could come, or a handful of you could come on March 23rd, I think it's at 7:30. The selectmen are going to be joined by the school committee and maybe the library trustees and town council, and they're going to talk about the ethics of an override. So what employees and volunteers can or can't say or do. I think it's really important to just get that out there early, because we've already run into a lot of questions with some of the volunteers.
I'm sorry,
the 22nd, selectmen. Yeah, sorry, the 22nd, right next door. No, that one's going to be at the senior center. I think it's at 7:30.
You said
8 o'clock.
8 o'clock.
Okay. Yeah, something else. Sharon's given a quarterly report in there somewhere. So at the senior center, 8 o'clock. And if you let me know, what we can post you. But it'd just be good if a few, you know, more than one of you came. Two is good. Two or three is good. And this is really meant for the board members and the public as much as anyone in the room, which is why we want to have it broadcast live.
I would suggest try to get to it if we can, more than a couple of people actually post for the meeting.
8 p.m.
The meeting starts at 7, so I'd get there probably 7:30, quarter of 8, just in case. We're running early.
Is this picking up on what Bill Brown said the last meeting?
I'm not sure.
I think it's more broadly speaking.
That was really FinCom, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's a different topic.
Okay.
Yeah. I think this really is by law what can we're town employees, but we're also citizens. And so what can and can't you do in those different roles?
Do you mind sending a reminder to Twitter?
I will.
Can we post for the 22nd, please? Can I just plan on it?
You won't be able to be there, though?
I will be able to.
Oh, you will?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I misunderstood.
Sorry. I'm just thinking it would be great for a broader group to kind of hear it and ask questions if there are any questions that come up. And then by virtue of having the elected boards there as well, I think it'll be great. What else do we need to talk about? Oh, yeah, good. We've come to the calendar. So, yeah, and then we meet the next night, the 23rd. So do you guys remember what your assignments were? Good. Okay, plan to do that. I will try to send them out if I can find them as well. Process questions. Anybody have a question on kind of what we're doing next? So we do part two of the town next Wednesday. The following week is the school committee will come in, and then Dr. Daugherty will present that budget. Then the week after that, we'll see if we need to have more. If not, we're in discussions, and we probably should be looking at the warrant.
You'll see that next week, the fourth week is meant for voting or discussion.
Okay.
If you need to have it. And you do have a fifth week if you need it. Do we sort of built into the schedule?
And I think we also talked about helping guide what the presentations may want to look like, what can make it more effective at town meeting. Obviously, we're talking about...
Yeah, that's a good point. The report that was sent to you, other than the one or two errors we need to fix, I didn't see any value in having org charts of individual departments go to town meeting. For you, maybe it was helpful. Town meeting, we did it last year. I don't think it was a benefit. I'd really like to cut this down, to be honest with you. But it's really hard to know. I mean, Munis takes a certain amount of time. The woman we hired, Jane, is actually on the Tewksbury School Committee right now. Her term is running out. I saw some of the ways other communities present budgets, and we could do a better job if we had time. The format we use is a Munis report plus Word. If we had more time, we could combine the two and put them in like a PowerPoint format, and it'd be much more concise. And then you should also have the discussion with the schools about you like their budget. I say budget in quotes because it's a lot more than a budget. There's a lot of stuff in there that's more of an operating manual and not an annual budget. And, you know, you really should discuss, is this, not for this year, obviously, but for the next year and for, you know, future years and for the voters, what is it that they should see as a concise packet? And my only opinion is, by looking at other towns, the town budget and the school budget usually have the exact same format. They don't in Reading. They never have, for whatever reason. Even the year that I went from landscape to portrait, Mary went the other way, and neither one of us told each other. We were each trying to match.
Right, so do they not have the munis output when they go?
They have no munis in their budget.
Okay.
They have tables.
I will say, I like
they provided the munis.
I like in your budget, I like the story, I like the word. And the problem is, it does take a certain amount of trust to believe the words. For munis supports the words, but I have that trust, so
well, the budget,
I have the munis, you know,
this is another thing with electronics. The munis stuff could all be online and not handed out to town meeting or to you.
Exactly.
And it could just be, here's the story.
Yeah.
And that's fine. I don't have a problem. Historically, that wasn't available for everyone, and, you know, Bill Brown would still want a hard copy of everything we can get to him. But more and more, that's a reasonable option for a lot of people.
Right.
Because honestly, how many people really want to look at every single line item? I mean, at some point, it's just the same thing every year.
The goal of seeing that the words, the story doesn't match up with the numbers?
Right. So these are things you could rightly think about right through the summer, and especially in terms of how we present to the public in the future. Because it's such a large budget between the town and the schools, I think it's discouraging for the average resident, even for me. It's just discouraging to sit through all that and try to understand it.
I'm sure a lot of work's put into those board documents.
Both the town and the schools spent a lot of time, you know, and as whoever it was, Churchill said, if we had more time, it'd be less.
Right.
You know, we could summarize it. That's the hard part. Mm-hmm. Is imagine, you know, if we were a business and we were doing an executive summary. Mm-hmm. I had a professor at Babson for MBA that said, there is no such thing, and there's no such project that ever went on a GE that took more than one page both sides, period. If it did, it didn't get considered. And he was the head of GE Europe for many years.
Mm-hmm. So
and that's how they operated.
GE. Because what we did, having been a GE employee, is what we did is we figured out how to, this is even before computers, this is WAN word processors, we figured out how to get more boxes and more words onto the page because you were limited in pages. So it was completely illegible. So you think of PowerPoint now, you want to have like two or three bullet points. We used to have at least eight boxes, each one being a full slide on one page, and we used the biggest paper we could find. We get like A3 paper or something. It was like this. So that it may be true, but it's
it could have been stretched.
And when you can play with fonts, it's not okay.
And margins.
And margin. Yeah, there weren't any margins.
6-point font.
It got to be ridiculous. Okay. What else? So we were just talking about process. So that gets us. We vote on week four. Fourth week. So that's today's what? Today is the 2nd. So that's the 23rd.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't think you have a problem with that.
For when?
April. Hang on. Okay. Actually, put it into the calendar.
25th
of April.
Possibly just one night. 25th, maybe 28th.
Cool.
April 25th.
Yeah, and then the 28th.
Because the early election really threw me off. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a change. So the only other comment would be, any questions that you guys have on the continuing budgets, it would be great to, first of all, have your questions ready, but if there's any chance of getting them in advance.
And I know John likes them in advance, too, if you have any school budget questions.
Yes.
I'm sure he'd appreciate them as soon as you can.
And I think if you kind of just take a few hours and kind of dig through the budget as soon as possible, you'll find that your questions come pretty quickly. And then just zip them off to us all. All right, anything else? So do we have any, we don't have them right now, but for next week, do we have any minutes that we need to look at?
No, I think you're up to date besides these ones. Those are the last
January forum? Did we do that already?
Well, there was another meeting after that.
You had one.
And we had another meeting after that, too, right?
Yeah,
all right.
So were you at that one? I can't remember.
Yeah,
you
were here.
I'll check.
I might have a minute somewhere.
When we post for a meeting, like a, we attend a school committee meeting or a selectman's meeting.
We just don't. We don't do minutes. We cut and paste the schools or the town or the selectman.
Okay, great.
And just say attended the meeting. Here's the minutes.
Exactly what I was hoping. Thank you. Okay, any other business? Oh, sorry. When we do the school one, do you think we're going to have an audience? Do you think there'll be more public people that will want to come? My guess would be yes.
Last time, yeah.
Can we look for a bigger venue?
Yeah.
And see if that's a possibility?
Yeah, I think we may have already decided to do that. I just don't remember.
16th, right?
Yeah. Sorry? I think we said that last meeting.
Yeah, I think we should.
I agree.
Because this room just isn't conducive to a crowd at all.
I'm assuming it's going to be Coolidge, but I'll let you know.
Great. Good. I have a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? We are 9-0 and Heidegger. Thanks, guys. Sorry.